Up next, a hearing held today on Capitol Hill by a House Energy and Commerce Subcommittee. Chairman John Dingell and his colleagues hear testimony on the use of counterfeit metal fasteners by the U.S. military.
Subcommittee will come to order. This morning, the subcommittee holds the fourth in a series of public hearings on the threat to public safety and the impact on interstate commerce of mismarked, substandard, and counterfeit fasteners. The hearings which the subcommittee has held prior to this time have disclosed matters which should shake the confidence of American people in imported bolts, fasteners, and in the manufacturers of those devices. Today, the subcommittee is forced to address the problem of dangerous nuts, bolts, and fasteners in the military equipment of the United States Armed Services. These fasteners threaten the lives of America's fighting men and women and the combat readiness of the armed services, particularly the United States Army. Last August, the subcommittee was told by the Defense Logistics Agency, the DLA, and the Army Material Command, AMC, and the Tank and Automotive Command, TACOM, that this serious problem was being solved. We intend to find out whether that, in fact, is true. To its credit, DLA has purged its inventories, segregating some 30 million substandard fasteners and preparing these for proper disposal. This is occasioned by the fact that ordinary disposal methods have usually resulted in these devices being recycled back into the supplies of the services and other services, which would then reinsert them not only into the supply system, but also into equipment. The Defense Industrial Supply Center, DISC, and the purchasing arm of DLA has revamped its contracting practices to procure replacements, tested those replacements, and declared them acceptable. The Army, however, has yet to notify the field units, what they call the posts, camps, and stations, that they even have a problem with regard to substandard fasteners, much less to order the inventories cleansed of substandard fasteners. Thus, the nation is faced with a situation today where defective bolts are replacing defective bolts at enormous maintenance cost and will have to be replaced again, we hope this time, with effective and adequate bolts. More importantly, the M60 tanks of the United States are incapable of traveling at the speeds for which they were designed and at which our battle plans are dependent upon. And not one, but two waivers have been granted to allow the use of non-conforming bolts in our new tank, the M1. Indeed, tracked vehicles in the Armed Services of the United States of all kinds keep losing their tracks, and wheeled vehicles have serious problems too. One cavalry sergeant at Fort Carson, Colorado, was so frustrated with his reconditioned M60 that he gave a statement detailing the bolt problem to his new commander on January 21, 1988. And I quote now, "In sincere hope of getting my new used tank track condemned, it seems that after spending 100 hours properly securing the tracks, bolts started popping within the first half miles, and it just got worse from there." The conclusion goes on, "Someone, including myself, could have been hurt, and I think the Army needs to find a better quality control system," close quote. The Hummer, or Humvees, which have replaced many Army vehicles from the Jeep to the ambulance, are in a state of perpetual repair instead of a state of perpetual readiness. Fort Ord, California, the home of the 7th Light Infantry Division, a vital part of America's rapid deployment force, is totally dependent upon the Hummer for mobility. Yet one battalion had 6 of 31 Hummers in the repair shop for an average of 6 days because of faulty fasteners. Ball joints are particularly vulnerable to the bad bolts. Some 75% of the Humvees at Fort Ord were found to have seriously loose ball joint bolts. Some could not be torqued properly. They just broke when the required stress was imposed upon them. One battalion officer got so frustrated that he went into town and bought replacement bolts with his own money. By a stroke of luck, He bought bolts made by a reputable domestic manufacturer, and they worked. I would hate to think that this must be the supply system upon which the United States will depend in keeping its forces up to readiness standards. These and many other cases were discovered during very cursory staff visits to both Fort Carson and Fort Ord, the only two locations where inquiries have been made. We have no reason to believe that the situation is any different anywhere else. Indeed, the burden to establish that the system is in fact working, that the supplies of bolts and fasteners are adequate, effective, and proper, is upon the services themselves. A tank commander at Fort Carson told an agent from the Defense Criminal Investigative Service, "If you want to collect samples of bad bolts, just follow my tanks down the road." We have just received information that provincial officials in Germany do just about the same thing, because their roads are strewn with broken bolts from American military vehicles. And the complaint is that these constitute a safety hazard to the motoring public of the Federal Republic of Germany. One must inquire what would be the case were the United States to have to depend upon military equipment held together by bolts and fasteners of this doubtful reliability if a major war were to break out. Most disturbing of all is the air of unreality at headquarters of AMC and its subordinate supply commands. Last summer, their witnesses testified, and I quote, "There were no bolt failures attributable to counterfeit bolts on the Humvee," close quote. That testimony was under oath. Yet every maintenance sergeant at Fort Ord can and will and does tell a different story. Last summer, the same agency testified, and I quote, "No waivers for contractors would be approved by TACOM after February 1, 1987. 14 months later, on March 31, 1988, they approved a waiver for General Dynamics to place non-conforming fasteners on 185 M1 tanks. Today, these quality assurance officials will appear before the committee again, accompanied by their superior officers. AMC has a motto that appears on all its stationery, and I quote, "providing soldiers with a decisive edge." I find it difficult to take that slogan seriously when AMC cannot provide them with an adequate supply of basic hardware like nuts and bolts. Perhaps the edge that is referred to there is not being supplied to the American military, but perhaps to the armed forces of others with whom our military might have to contend in the event of serious difficulties. Chair recognizes my dear friend from Oregon for an opening statement.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. I want to commend you, Mr. Chairman, for undertaking what I think is a particularly important inquiry. When these hearings began, Mr. Chairman, the counterfeit bolt problem seemed to be a simple case of greed and deception. Some manufacturers and distributors were out to make a fast buck by palming off cheap goods as top of the line. But now this story is one of bureaucratic bungling. And I'd like to give just an example. The Air Force uses Class 3 fasteners in critical aerospace applications. But an Air Force document received by the subcommittee this morning, a document dated March 31, 1988, indicates that there are no plans to get rid of the bad fasteners now sitting in the depots and field inventories. My concern, Mr. Chairman, is that these bolts will simply be used in the normal course of maintenance, and what we'll have is a situation where bad bolts are replaced with bad bolts. Now, in that same memorandum, the Air Force does state that it intends to figure out what applications are the most critical, and it will advise the field not to use substandard fasteners in the critical spots. But unfortunately, our airmen in the field shouldn't hold their breaths waiting for that information. The memo shows that it isn't scheduled to get to all of the airmen until April 28, 1989. What's more, the Air Force isn't taking any action based on what we've seen to this point concerning the critical grade 8 fasteners that have been the focus of many of these hearings. Those grade 8 fasteners are intended, of course, for ground applications. Now, that's not to say that the Air Force doesn't use grade 8s or that counterfeits aren't a threat to their equipment. It's just that it seems that the bureaucracy has its head in the clouds and that they haven't come down to earth to consider the safety and performance threats to the ground-based equipment. The last point I'd make, Mr. Chairman, is that when General Piketty, commander of the Defense Industrial Supply Center, testified before the subcommittee last August, he told us that DISC would have counterfeit Class 3 fasteners identified and segregated by last September. I think it's particularly important to know whether that promise has been kept, and I look forward to testimony on that point. But, Mr. Chairman, it seems clear that DISC's actions alone haven't been enough. We've got to do something to clean out the bad fasteners actually in use or held as backups in the field. Anything short of that is simply not taking the steps that we need to protect our forces. And I commend you, Mr. Chairman, for what I think is a particularly important inquiry.
Chair, thanks, my dear friend. The gentleman from Ohio, Mr. Oxley.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. This is another important hearing in the series we have held on the widespread problem of counterfeit, mismarked, and substandard bolts. We have heard the horror stories about how unscrupulous foreign manufacturers and importers have sold bad bolts into the stream of commerce. We received testimony about the adverse effects this has had on our domestic industry and our military services, which are dependent upon quality bolts in a wide range of products and defense systems. I am distressed to see evidence that the Army has not proceeded satisfactorily to purge its existing stocks of suspect bolts. Army representatives testified last August that this problem was being taken care of, but somehow the message never got down to the field units. As a consequence, we have stocks that are contaminated with defective bolts. We have vehicles and equipment supposedly ready for rapid deployment overseas that require constant maintenance and are not, in fact, ready for deployment. It is unbelievable to me that a problem so crucial to our military readiness was not given the attention required to solve it. A bolt may be small and inexpensive, but its failure can cause great problems. I'm eager to find out today what brought us to this state of affairs. I'm also eager to learn from the Defense Department officials appearing today when the Army expects to have inventories of bolts free from defective bolts, and when our troops in the field can expect to have equipment that works in a safe and effective manner. Mr. Chairman, as the old poem goes, for want of a nail, the shoe was lost. For want of a shoe, the horse was lost. For want of a horse, the war was lost, etc. Perhaps we've got the same problem with the defective bolts. And Mr. Chairman, as you know, I do have the Lima tank plant in my district that makes the M1A1 Abrams tank, and I'll have a series of questions for our panelists specifically in regard to that operation. And with that, I yield back the balance of my time.
Chair, thanks, gentlemen. Time of the gentleman has expired. Chair notes that our first two witnesses will be Mr. David W. Nelson, economist, and Mr. Thomas M. Dorney, special assistant. Both of these gentlemen are members of the staff of the Committee on Oversight and Investigations and have been functioning as investigators in connection with the business of the committee this morning. The chair will impose upon our two witnesses the usual requirements. Gentlemen, do you have any objection to testifying under oath?
No.
Gentlemen, for your information, copies of the rules of the committee, the subcommittee, the rules of the House are also there before you at the witness table. Gentlemen, do either of you desire to be advised by counsel during your appearance before the committee?
No.
Very well, gentlemen, if you will please each rise and raise your right hand. Gentlemen, do you solemnly swear the testimony you're about to give is truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth, so help you God?
I do.
Gentlemen, you may each consider yourself to be under oath, and if you please, would you proceed with your statement in the fashion most suitable to you?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and good morning to you and the members of the subcommittee. I'm David Nelson, an economist on the staff of the subcommittee and one of three subcommittee staff members assigned to the investigation involving substandard, mismarked, and counterfeit fasteners. I'm presenting today the combined testimony of the staff, which includes Stephen Sims, special assistant currently on the dais, and Thomas Dorney, also a special assistant, seated next to me at the witness table. Mr. Chairman, I intend to summarize the staff's statement. I'd like to have the entire statement placed in the record together with the exhibits at the appropriate place.
You may proceed, John.
Following an executive session hearing on this topic on March 23, 1988, Chairman Dingell dispatched us to Fort Carson, Colorado and Fort Ord, California to determine the validity of allegations regarding a continuing and pervasive fastener problem in active Army units, including those designated for the Rapid Deployment Force. On April 13, 1988, Steve Sims, Tom Dorney, and myself visited the 7th Light Infantry Division at Fort Ord, California. We were accompanied by three agents of the Defense Criminal Investigative Service, DCIS, Kevin Kuhns from Headquarters, Bob Bauman and Michael Krebs, field agents from Northern California. Colonel Bob Williams from Army Liaison was also present. Our purpose was to check the fasteners on the vehicles and in the inventory of the 7th Infantry to see if there were any problems with substandard, mismarked, or counterfeit bolts. We chose the 7th Infantry because fastener problems had previously been identified by Agents Bauman and Krebs. A copy of their report is attached to the testimony as Exhibit A. And because this unit is supposed to have the capability to deploy overseas on a moment's notice. In fact, recently elements of the 7th Infantry went to Honduras along with elements of the 82nd Airborne, and other elements of the 7th Infantry are currently in Panama. The vehicles of the units we visited contained a number of fasteners from foreign manufacturers whose bolts had previously been found substandard in numerous laboratory tests, including those conducted by the Department of Defense. Moreover, every level of maintenance, from the unit level to the general support level, had inventories that were contaminated with the same type of fasteners. Furthermore, the combat units were experiencing severe fastener problems on their vehicles to the extent that the combat readiness of certain units was affected. Finally, maintenance and supply personnel of all ranks, from private to colonel, indicated that elimination of all suspect fasteners would essentially put them out of business. These individuals pointed out they were aware of the suspect fasteners, but this was what had been provided, so they had little choice but to use them. They also pointed out that the Army Depot supply system continued to supply suspect fasteners right up to the day of our visit. Units of the 7th Infantry were experiencing persistent problems in several areas of their high-mobility, multi-purpose wheeled vehicle, or Hummer or Humvee as they're more commonly known. The written testimony details these problems. They include loosening of the bolts in the upper ball joints of the front wheel assembly. This causes tire wear, fastener failure, and if not corrected, loss of steering. We were told that about 75% of the nearly 1,000 Humvees at Fort Ord had experienced loose bolts in the upper ball joint. The second major problem was the failure of bolts securing the alternator bracket to the engine compartment. It is a large consumer of maintenance hours because the bolts often had to be drilled out prior to replacement. Another problem was bolt failures on the starter motor. In two instances, bolt failures caused other damage, which in turn caused fires that destroyed the wiring harness and the electrical cables. Of the 102 Humvees in the inventory of the 9th Regiment, 51 were found to have loose bolts, and 7 vehicles had been lost from service because of broken bolts or stripped threads. In one battalion, 6 vehicles have been lost for an average of 6 days each, which is about one-third of the Humvees assigned to that unit. One of the vehicles experienced bolt failure even though the bolts had been checked and tightened only 2 days before. The situation got so bad that the battalion executive officer bought replacement bolts from the civilian economy with money from his own pocket in order to get the unit's vehicles ready. By a stroke of luck, he obtained domestic bolts at a local hardware store, which on the West Coast is an incredible coincidence. In the motor pool, we asked to have the wheel of one Humvee removed so that we could inspect the bolts in the ball joint. We found 3 grade 8s and 1 grade 5, even though the military specification called for all grade 8s. The grade 5 bolt was apparently installed at the factory by AM General, the manufacturer. In this regard, we observed dozens of Humvees, all of which had a variety of different bolts, mostly foreign, many of which were of suspect quality that had been installed, obviously, as original equipment by AM General. The maintenance officer of the 2nd Brigade told us that some of their vehicles had experienced problems with bolts on the generator mounting bracket during the recent deployment to Honduras. We were there, I think, 2 or 3 weeks after they got back from Honduras. He also said that 2 years ago, 3 bolts near the ball joint broke, ruining the upper control arm. About 25 replacement bolts broke when they were installed during attempted repairs. The shop supervisor of the 707 Maintenance Battalion, which is in direct support of the 7th Infantry, said they had to repair bolt failures on Humvees about 2 or 3 times per week. A 5-ton truck, an M939, was in the shop that day because of the failure of bolts on the transmission bell housing. The 707th had seen 5 or 6 cases of this in the last 8 months. One of the sergeants told us that 12 grade 8 bolts with no manufacturer's mark on their head had been received earlier that day through Army Depot supply channels. I examined 34 drawers in which bolts were kept for use in this one particular shop. 33 contained grade 8 and 5 bolts with either no manufacturer's mark or marks of foreign manufacturers that have proven substandard in the past, such as KS or FM. Our inspection of these and other units found bolt inventories to be generally contaminated with fasteners without manufacturer's marks or with the marks of manufacturers known to have supplied substandard bolts in the past. On April 14th, the next day, we visited Fort Carson, Colorado. Here we were accompanied by the Defense Criminal Investigative Service Agent Curtis Workman from the Denver office, in addition to Agent Kuhns and Colonel Williams. Agent Workman had done an inspection of vehicles and fastener inventories at Fort Carson in February 1988. A copy of his report is attached as Exhibit B.
Exhibits A and B and also Exhibit C attached to your statement will be included in the record at the appropriate place.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. We first met with the Director of Logistics and with the TACOM representative. TACOM is the Tank and Automotive Command. Like at Fort Ord, they had received no messages from TACOM headquarters, DISC, or any other Army element warning them of counterfeit or substandard bolts. Also like Fort Ord, the inventories of combat units and maintenance facilities we visited were filled with bolts whose quality was suspect based on their head markings or lack thereof. We visited the 4th Battalion of the 68th Armor, a unit of the 4th Infantry Division mechanized. The commander of the headquarter company and the motor sergeants told us that bolt failure was a recurring problem. The 4th Infantry has primarily tracked vehicles and has not gotten its full complement of Hummers yet. The Hummers they did have were built with the same mixture of suspect bolts that we saw at Fort Ord and even had a few marked as grade 8.2s. The primary bolting problems at Fort Carson were with tracked vehicles, including the M60A3 tanks, the M88 tank retrievers, the M106 mortar carriers, the M113 scout vehicles, personnel carriers, and tow missile carriers. The officers and sergeants pointed out that many of the bolt failures were not reported because the vehicle operators fixed the problem on the spot and the maintenance people never saw them. In fact, the operators of the tanks had standing orders every time the tank came to rest to get out and check the bolts on the tracks. However, one unit prepared a report with individual statements covering the problems they'd encountered. This statement is attached as Exhibit C. It reports with eloquence the frustration and anger of our soldiers in attempting to fulfill their duties while being continuously plagued with substandard fasteners. It should be required reading for every individual involved in the resupply of our troops. Two serious problem areas were bolts shearing on the sprocket wheel, which turns the tracks and propels the vehicle, and the wedge bolts, which hold together the shoes that make up the track. This is a wedge bolt. And this one had just broken loose when they tried to torque it. Snapped in two. In many cases, the bolts would come loose and fall out without breaking. This one happened to break. The suspicion that the maintenance people advanced was this may be due to the use of zinc plating rather than cadmium plating. The torque specs are for cadmium plating, which is what the contracts require. But as Dis testified last year, about 80% level of substitution of zinc for cadmium plating in grade 8 bolts was the level found in their inventories, even though CAD had been specified and paid for in the torque manuals are calibrated to cadmium plating. On January 26, 1988, bolt failure on one final drive assembly of an M106 caused about $6,000 to the engine and drivetrain. This vehicle experienced the failure when returning from the division wash rack. It had been fitted with a new U-joint the day before. We visited the 2nd Squadron of the 7th Cavalry. They reported many bolt failures. In October 1987, end carrier bolts holding the shoes of the track failed. More recently, all bolts on the sprocket wheel of three M88 tank retrievers sheared. One M88 was repaired and went about 25 miles when the bolt sheared again. In a recent two-week exercise, the unit's tanks had lost about 400 bolts and 6 of the tanks were rendered non-mission capable. 3 5-ton trucks also lost grade 8 bolts that connect the transmission to the frame, and 2 improved tow vehicles had bolts that sheared on the U-joint to the final drive assembly. At the division maintenance facility, we were told that fastener failures occurred in the disc brake calibers in 4 of the 10 Humvees that had been sent to that facility for repair. A shop foreman working on tanks handed us a specially designed nut that has a bell-shaped cup, as you can see. And he stated that he almost lost an eye when installing and torquing these nuts. He explained that the bell-shaped cup had shattered before reaching specified torque. He went on to say that all the nuts' bell-shaped cups break as often as not, and they're really junk. These nuts hold the bolts, which in turn hold the assemblies which drive the tank. When asked what he would use in lieu of the junk, the shop foreman just shrugged and stated they were all he had. At a general meeting of division personnel, we were shown several examples of problem fasteners. And these were fasteners that they chose out of their bins, not that we had chosen. One bag contained 10 bolts, all ordered to the same national stock number, which specified a grade 8 bolt with a chrome 8 surface. Instead, the supply system shipped 10 grade 5s or grade 2s, all of different manufacturers, and 6 of which were improperly plated. Mr. Dorning was provided 2 bolts as an exhibit, one good and one bad, from the aircraft maintenance section at Fort Ord. These are rotating bolts used on the UH-1 or UE helicopters. According to aircraft maintenance personnel, failure of the rotating bolts could result in catastrophic loss. The bad bolt tested to half the Rockwell hardness requirement. They told us they shuddered at the thought that they could have installed the bad bolts in a helicopter of an active duty unit and questioned whether they would be as lucky the next time. Mr. Chairman, while the quality deficiency reports, or QDRs from the field, which is the primary vehicle the Army uses for receiving complaints from the field about material, and even the reports from the Defense Criminal Investigative Service about the situations at Fort Carson and Fort Ord, had little impact on the Army Material Command bureaucrats in Alexandria. But the staff visits and the intended possibility of congressional hearings produced a flood of activity. Brigadier General Pagotti requested a staff visit to DISC headquarters in Philadelphia for a briefing on the progress made since the hearings last August. DISC, a division of the Defense Logistics Agency, is a principal procurement source for all DOD units. They have made considerable progress since last August in purging their system of substandard materials. In fact, at that meeting, DISC informed us they are now capable of replacing all substandard bolts in all field unit inventories within a matter of months, provided they get the requisitions, that is. Unfortunately, the supply branches of at least 2 of the armed services appear to have taken a head-in-the-sand approach to the fastener problem. The Air Force Logistics Command, AFLC, has apparently made a decision not to even try to purge its inventories. Their justification, in part, consists of a belief that grade 8 bolts are not used in aircraft or missiles themselves, but only in the ground support systems. The Army Material Command knows that grade 8 bolts are the mainstay fasteners of its vehicle and weapon systems and has made a half-hearted effort to address the problem beginning as early as the fall of 1986. Unfortunately, they have yet to purge their field inventories and to insist that defense contractors provide equipment without suspect fasteners. As in many other areas of quality control, the Army appears to view maintenance, at least the man hours of personnel, as an inconsequential expense, but line stoppages as events to be avoided at all cost, even if it means that troops are supplied with substandard equipment. Most serious of all is the fact they have yet to order the inventories in the field cleansed of known or suspect fasteners. Consequently, as we learned at Fort Ord and Fort Carson, defective fasteners are being replaced by defective fasteners in the high-stress applications where they repeatedly loosen or break. This attitude contrasts with that of the Navy, which not only purged its inventories of suspect fasteners identified by DISC, they conducted independent testing of bolts and inventory at their shipyards and found non-conforming fasteners that DISC had missed, probably because they had already passed through the DISC inventories. That concludes our written, oral statement, Mr. Chairman. We'll be happy to answer any questions you or the other committee may have, other members of the committee may have.
Thank you very much, gentlemen. Chair has a few questions to direct to Mr. Dorney. Mr. Dorney, the Quality Deficiency Reporting System, or QDR, is the primary tool used by the Army and other services for field troops to report equipment problems to higher headquarters. After technical evaluation, the higher headquarters sends a response containing appropriate corrective action. In this way, the system is supposed to work. And based on your investigation at Fort Carson and Fort Ord, is this the way the system actually works?
Yes, Mr. Chairman, that's the way it is supposed to work. However, it was not the way it worked at Fort Carson and Fort Ord. Based on interviews with sergeants through the rank of bird colonel, every one of these individuals freely admitted to us that in the vast majority of cases where they experienced bolt failures, they did not prepare QDRs. And there was ready agreement among virtually all of the personnel we spoke with that the QDR system essentially was something someone else had to handle. They did not prepare any forms whatsoever.
Mr. Dorney, in their testimony last year, the Army appeared to base much of their argument that bolt problems did not exist or were minor on the fact that they didn't have many QDRs. What you're telling me is that this is not a correct premise. Am I correct in that?
That's correct, sir. Essentially, no one at Ord or Carson were preparing QDRs. Therefore, the assumption that no news is good news is incorrect. And in fact, the QDR system has been recognized as being faulty by a number of different organizations, including the Department of Defense Council on Quality Assurance, who have been actively studying the QDR system with the knowledge that most of the failures are not being reported under this system.
You're saying to us that there is no one at these two stations who are charged with the responsibility of preparing QDRs?
Pardon me, sir?
You're telling us that there is no one at these two stations who have the responsibility for preparing QDRs?
Every individual who experiences a failure is supposed to be responsible for filling out a QDR. However, the troops in the field feel their responsibility is getting the equipment back on the road. So they repair the vehicle, and that's the end of it. They do not, in essence, view filling out paperwork as being their primary area of responsibility.
Do you have some QDRs there you'd like to tell us about?
Yes, sir. There was at least two QDRs that were prepared by the aircraft maintenance department. These people at the aircraft maintenance department pointed out to me that in one instance, on the helicopter rotator bolts, that they did everything which they were required to do. prepared the QDR after they identified faulty material. It took 6 weeks approximately before AVSCOM, which is the aviation supply organization of the Army, to respond to them. The response of AVSCOM, as it's called, indicated that they had sent the QDR on to the DLA for further investigation. 7 months later, the folks at ORD still had not received any definitive answer to why they had received bad rotator bolts that they could have installed in a helicopter. In another instance, they prepared QDRs on hydraulic fluid filters. The folks categorized the QDR there, air would not go through these filters, much less hydraulic fluids. However, again, the folks at AVSCOM simply shut it off by saying, well, there was only two that failed, and they only cost $36 a piece, scrap the rest, and that will close the case. So the troops not only don't fill these out, but in the cases when they do attempt to comply with the regulations, they feel a great deal of frustration and anger because they do not feel that the upper level commands are responding with the action they would like to see happen.
Now, Mr. Dorney, perhaps this is a question which we will later address to the Army, but I think it would be useful if you were to clear up some of the confusion that might surround the questions. Can you explain why DISC and DESCOM purged their inventories of non-conforming fasteners, but the Army did not see fit to do so, at least until this hearing was scheduled, to purge bolt inventories of troops in the field at camps, posts, and stations?
That is obviously a contradiction. DISC began their purge. The Army began a purge at depot, but they left their camps, posts, and stations completely alone. Ironically, the depot supply system of the Army exists to serve the troops, but we left the troops with the bad bolts and preferred to try to purge the depot system. So it was obviously a contradiction. Ideally, the action should have been comparable to the Navy's, where all bolts were purged simultaneously.
Chair, thanks, gentlemen. The chair recognizes the gentleman from Oregon, Mr. White.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I just have one question at this point, gentlemen. General Pigott did tell us last August that DISC would have counterfeit Class 3 fasteners identified and segregated by last September. Do either of you gentlemen know whether that commitment has been kept?
I think that General Pigotti will be testifying today, and it would be most appropriate to ask him the question. We focused our most recent inquiries on the Grade 8 problem. The Class 3 aerospace problems, obviously just as serious, if not more serious, because these are bolts that go into aircraft and missiles. Our cursory reading of the message traffic that we obtained in preparation from this hearing would indicate that if they have segregated and begin the purge of their inventories, it's been a rather recent event.
So it was not done by last September based on what you have picked up from reading those messages?
Well, again, the messages didn't deal directly with this issue, so I think it'd probably be far better to ask General Pigotti himself.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Chair, thanks, gentlemen. Gentleman from Ohio, Mr. Oxley.
Thank you. Gentlemen, you stated that DISC has made considerable progress in purging its inventories of substandard bolts. The problem you've identified in the Army is at the camp, post, and station level. As I understand it, these bolts move from disc depots to service depots to active units and other end uses. Similarly, the message about purging defective bolts was supposed to be transmitted down through these levels. Can you tell us how far this chain did, how far down did in the chain did this message reach in regard to defective bolts?
Well, most of the messages got to the Army depot level. There were two that were somehow lost at DESCOM, two disc messages that contained about 97 different contract numbers, which I think equates to millions of bolts that should have been purged, that somehow or another that got lost at either AMC or DESCOM headquarters because they didn't get to the depots. But all the other messages to take contracts with certain numbers on them that were in stock and purge all the bolts reached the depot level, but they did not go to the retail level, to the post camps and station inventories, at least not to those at Fort Ord and Fort Carson that we went to, and we saw no message traffic whatsoever up until May 5th, last Wednesday, or last Thursday, after a meeting that we had, that the staff had at AMC, where any message traffic went to the field about purging any bolts, or even informing them they had a problem.
Is it only at the bottom of the chain where the defective bolts still exist, in your estimation?
Well, there is one other class of bolts that probably have not been tested at the Army Depot level system. What DISC did was take all of its fasteners that were in inventory, that were identifiable by contract number, and test a sample of each contract. To the extent that DISC had already purchased material and shipped it through to the Army depots and no longer had material from that contract number still in its inventory, but those numbers were in the Army depot inventory, those would not have been tested. I'd say they probably got most of them. DISC has 30 million bolts that they've identified as substandard that they're preparing to destroy when the U.S. Attorney's Office releases them. The Army Depot Command has another 2.5 million bolts that conform to the same contract numbers that they're prepared to destroy. There are probably a percentage of bolts that have never been tested, plus a percentage of bolts that were in messages 5 and 7 that were never received by the depot systems commander at the depot level that have not been purged yet. But other than that, the wholesale level of the Army is probably in pretty good shape.
Mr. Durney?
We should mention that the very last message issued by the Army Depot Systems Command to their depots regarding messages 5 and 7 was not sent out until April 28th of this year. Therefore, the depots still have considerable purging action to take prior to assurances that their inventories are clean.
Someone said there's always somebody that doesn't get the message. Where did the message system particularly break down in your estimation?
The commanding general of DESCOM will be at the witness table later on. We were not given any explanation of why DESCOM could receive messages 1 through 4, message 6, message 8 through 13, and not notice that it didn't get messages 5 and 7.
So neither one of you have actually seen 5 or 7?
No, we know the messages went out from DISC. We've seen 5 and 7, but we were told they were never received at DESCOM.
We have copies of those messages now in the proper time frame. However, it was only last Wednesday that they advised us of this.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Chair, thanks, gentlemen. Gentlemen from Ohio. Gentlemen from Virginia, Mr. Boucher. Gentlemen, can you tell us one thing that I think would be helpful to the committee? What is there here to make us believe that the two stations which you visited in the course of your investigations on behalf of the committee are any different than any other station in the Army with regard to the adequacy of fasteners in supply and the questions that would be associated with regard to functional operation, reliability, and safety of equipment because of quality or lack of quality fasteners being present?
There's nothing. In fact, at I believe it was Fort Carson, Bird Colonel in charge of logistics had talked to his counterpart at Fort Hood, Texas, and he was told that they had the same problems down there. We had hoped, quite frankly, with regard to the track vehicles, that the M1's record might be better than the M60's because they're newer vehicles, until we received the correspondence from Germany, which suggests that
that they're having problems with.
Communication from Mr. Willie Segeth to Mr. Sims.
Yes.
Complaining about the number of broken bolts and studs that have fallen off American armored vehicles clogging the roads in the state of Hesse in the German Federal Republic. Is that correct?
That's correct.
Makes excellent reading. Mr. Einloft, who is the chief of the Department of Road Construction in the state of Hesse, made this observation. All we have to do is follow the broken bolts, and we can find any one of your tanks in the forest. Without objections, the entirety of the document will be inserted into the record. Gentlemen, do you have any further comments for the committee? Any further questions for the chairman? Gentleman from Ohio.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Just briefly, you had drawn a distinction between the Army and the Navy as to how those bolts were handled, and that the Navy, in fact, had pursued the substandard bolts and had extricated them from the system. Is that correct?
That's correct. They sent when the disc messages about the bad contract, the bolts corresponding to the bad contract numbers went to the naval supply channels. They sent it out immediately, not just to the naval supply bases, but to all the ships and their other stations. And they undertook a program of testing their own inventory for contracts not identified by DISC as being containing bad fasteners, and found another 9 contracts that they then informed DISC about, who then sent those numbers out to all the other services. The Navy apparently had a comprehensive reaction program to any information about bad fasteners.
In contrast, the Army, that apparently was a kind of hit or miss operation.
That's right, and the Air Force, who chose to define away the problem altogether.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
You've indicated that the gentleman in your statement just summarized that you have, that we have major problems with regard to inventories of replacement fasteners. You've also indicated that these fasteners are a major problem as they are incorporated into vehicles. Did you find the situation any different with regard to newly purchased equipment and the fasteners on those vehicles?
Quite frankly, Mr. Chairman, the only newly purchased equipment that we saw were the new Hummers. We didn't look at any M1 tanks. Fort Carson doesn't have any M1 tanks. And of course, Fort Ord is a light infantry unit. They don't have any tanks at all. But the new Hummers, including ones that had yet to be dispatched for use, that is to say, they still had the seats wrapped and were sitting in the pre-dispatch state at both Ord and Carson, were permeated with fasteners whose head marks either did not disclose the manufacturer or were where the manufacturer's mark was known to have supplied substandard material to the military and to civilian sectors in the past.
Gentlemen, for the further questions for the witnesses. Chair is none. Gentlemen, you were excused with the thanks of the committee.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you very much for your presence and for your assistance today. Chair announces that our next witnesses will be a panel composed of Lieutenant Jerry M. Bunyard, Deputy Commander, U.S. Army Material Command, Major General William S. Flynn, Commanding General, U.S. Army Tank Automotive Command, Brigadier General William B. McGrath. Testifying on behalf of the Department of Defense will be Lieutenant General Vincent M. Russo, Commander, Defense Logistics Agency, Cameron Station, Alexandria, Virginia, and Brigadier General Leo J. Bugatti, as well as Mr. Seymour J. Lorber, Deputy Chief of Staff for Product Assurance and Testing, and Mr. Lowell H. Barnett, Director, Product Assurance and Testing. Gentlemen, we thank you for your assistance to the committee, for your presence here today. Gentlemen, I'm sure you are aware that all witnesses appearing before the committee under the practices of the committee are sworn. Do any of you have any objection to testifying under oath? Very well. Gentlemen, the chair should advise you of two things. First, that copies of the rules of the committee, the subcommittee, and the House of Representatives are there in the red and the brown books to inform you of the rules of the House and the limitations that they impose upon the committee and the affirmative protections that they afford your rights. Gentlemen, do any of you desire to be advised by counsel during your appearance here this morning? Very well. Gentlemen, you may each rise, please, and raise your right hand. Gentlemen, do you solemnly swear that the testimony you are about to give is the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth, so help you God? Gentlemen, you may each consider yourself under oath. Okay. Gentlemen, I understand that General Russo and General Bunyard have a joint statement. I believe you will present it, General Russo. Very well, you are recognized for your statement. Thank you for being with us.
I'm General Vincent M. Russo, Director of the Defense Logistics Agency. And with me here today are Lieutenant General Bunyard and Mr. Lorber from the Army Materiel Command, Major General Flynn and Mr. Barnett from the Army. Okay.
We have, without a question of doubt, the worst loudspeaker and amplifying system in the government in this room.
No fastener in there, sir.
No fastener. Matter of fact, I don't even know whether it's foreign made, but it certainly does not function.
Very well, sir. Sir, I mentioned General Bunyard and Mr. Lorber from the Army Materiel Command, Mr. Flynn and Mr. Barnett from the Army Tank Automotive Command, Brigadier General McGrath of the Army Depot Systems Command, and Brigadier General Leo Pagotti, the Commander of the Defense Industrial Supply Center. With your approval, I want to submit our joint written testimony for the record and orally summarize the Defense Logistics Agency's efforts to solve the counterfeit and substandard fastener problems. Following my statement, General Bunyard will summarize the Army's activity in this matter. I thought perhaps before starting, I would make, I've placed a chart in front of each of you, and the chart looks something like this. And I thought it might be helpful to review that very quickly to show you where we are. I know you don't like abbreviations, so I'll flow through that fairly quickly. OSD, Office of Secretary of Defense, on your left, the defense agencies, and I'm one of those defense agencies, the Defense Logistics Agency. You notice that within my organization, you'll see DISC, or the Defense Industrial Supply Center, and that's commanded by General Pagotti. Flowing over to your right on that chart, you see the military departments. Below that, the Department of the Army. And then you see the Army Materiel Command, or AMC, is a subordinate of DA, and that's where you'll find General Bunyard and Mr. Lorber. Subordinate to AMC is the Armament, Munitions, and Chemical Command, AMCCOM, TACOM, commanded by General Flynn, and he and Mr. Barnett of that command are here today, and DESCOM, or the Depot Systems Command, is commanded by General McGrath, who also is one of the witnesses here today. Last August, in testimony before this committee, we in DLA reported that we had a serious problem in common with industry, in that millions of counterfeit and substandard fasteners had infested our supply system. At that hearing, we described actions that we initiated to deal with this problem. Our initial attempts were slow, and much inertia had to be overcome, but we promised that swift and aggressive actions would be taken. We made a commitment to rid our inventory of inferior fasteners and to prevent recurrence of this problem and to punish those who deliberately supplied substandard products to the United States government. The first commitment we made was to cleanse our inventory of counterfeit grade 8 bolts and screws. We promised to fulfill this commitment by Thanksgiving, 5 months after we had frozen over 90 million parts. I'm pleased to report that essentially we kept this promise, and we have weeded out about 30 million fasteners that have been segregated. Throughout our inventory cleansing effort, we kept the logistics and contracting community informed. We provided timely customer updates and suspension reports. We provided users of fasteners with information regarding our findings, and we put the supplier community on notice that DLA had initiated procedures that would reject all non-conforming product. We also notified our suppliers that we intended, to prosecute those suppliers intentionally defrauding the government. Another commitment we made was to substitute safeguards to prevent recurrence. We've been aggressively enforcing the special contractual clauses that were developed to improve the way we assure quality and traceability. We are testing each grade A contract. We are closely scrutinizing quality compliance documentation. In addition, we are moving to weed out those suppliers who have demonstrated that they cannot be trusted to deal honestly and fairly with the government. As an update to the figures I provided in my written statement to the subcommittee, we have, as of today, debarred 11 companies and individuals from future government business because of their involvement in the fastener problem. An additional 16 companies and individuals are currently being considered for debarment, including a wholesale fastener supplier convicted of smuggling charges relating to the importation of grade 8.2 screws falsely marked as grade 8 screws. DLA provides administration of military service contracts in a number of contractor facilities. In January of 1987, we initiated an effort to ensure that contractors purged their stocks of all grade 8.2 and counterfeit or mismarked bolts. Following this, our implant quality assurance representatives included in their surveillance plan actions to first, ensure that contractors have adequate procedures to screen substandard bolts. Second, verify the existence of objective quality evidence of such screening prior to government acceptance of the end items. And this evidence would get into test procedures, test results, equipment calibration, and the like. Third, assure contractor control of non-conforming fastener segregation. For the Defense Industrial Supply Center, grade 8 bolt contracts, we are requiring our suppliers to submit a certificate of quality compliance with each shipment. The certificate includes traceability information down to the manufacturing lot level and results of their inspections and tests. Our implant quality assurance representatives are tasked to verify the certificate is complete and furnished for each lot, to also verify contractor compliance to calibration requirements for inspection equipment, also perform product verification inspections, that is our own independent inspections, to include independent testing of each lot. Finally, our implant folks verify the manufacturer identification marked on bolt heads. The most effective deterrent to the willful delivery of substandard product is expeditious prosecution with tough penalties and debarment or suspension of contractors. We have made a total commitment to the support of the Defense Criminal Investigative Service and the Attorney General's staff in placing these criminals behind bars. The bottom line is that we have seen a reversal with regard to grade 8 fastener quality, one that has taken us from a 30% non-conforming rate to where the material substitution victimizing us before has all but disappeared. Even before we froze our inventory, some contracts awarded but not yet delivered were abandoned by those fearful of being caught. Our efforts, we think, are beginning to pay off. Mr. Chairman, in closing, I believe that we in the Defense Logistics Agency are aggressively pursuing the fight against the fastener problems that have plagued us. You should know that this effort has not come cheaply, and in my agency alone, we have invested over $5 million to combat a problem that has been undetected for many years. The battle is not over by any means. We do not intend to grow complacent. but I assure you that the Defense Logistics Agency will employ every reasonable effort to ensure that only quality fasteners are delivered to our armed forces. Sir, I would like to turn now to General Bunyard for his oral comment.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman and members of the committee. It is a pleasure to appear here before the committee this morning to discuss a concern which we jointly share. This concern, which affects each of us, each and every day, in numerous ways. The concern, of course, is the basic bolt. In an era in which technology is expanding rapidly, it's humbling as I remind myself that the basics which hold our equipment, much less our ability to defend freedom together, can come down to the simple, seemingly inconsequential bolt. Bolts have become a focal point for a situation which has a scope that is much greater than we first assumed. As recently as about a week ago, I queried some 1,200 logistics assistance representatives that we have working side by side with our soldiers throughout the entire world. Now, we have known for months that the test results from our labs, what that said, but we, like you, wanted to know precisely what is happening to the equipment that is out there being used in the field. Now, the response that I received from those 1,200 people has been invaluable in trying to pinpoint causes and not simply the effects, and trying to give a very good definition to what the bolt issue is all about. We find that we're dealing with not just bolts, but contractor integrity and compliance, testing accuracy and reliability, inventory control, maintenance practices, and even equipment design. Unfortunately, corrective action is needed in all of these areas. Now, we thought we had approached the issue in the right manner by first pursuing the source of supply, in other words, trying to cut off the flow of bad bolts. We did this by pursuing the wholesale department. We notified our major subordinate commands, to include our depot systems command, who in turn notified all of their depots to ensure that the wholesale stock had been properly cleaned up. Just as a matter of information, this reporting chain includes some 120,000 personnel within the Army. Now, we thought we had a grip on the situation, but in reality and in retrospect, we did not cover the entire spectrum. However, I'm very quick to point out that the reports from our 1,200 field representatives worldwide confirmed that there has not been any discernible trends of bolt failures over the last 2 years. It had not been any better, nor had it been any worse. Nor was there any quantifiable safety or readiness impacts that were caused by bolts. The initial purge of industry and depot stocks was not a thorough purge. For example, one of our major contractors has just gone through a full repurge, costing as much as $250,000, and it may go higher. Testing has been only sporadically applied in the past. Although we required testing, less than 30% of our contractors applied the full spectrum to include pull testing or tensile strength. We have found in those instances where local purchase was authorized, even for critical applications, where no testing is required. Quality acceptance was based on a paper certification. But where we were most remiss is that no real attempt has been made on our part to fully educate the soldier in the field as to the differences in bolts and the criticality of their application. We have found a lack of effective control of shop stock. There is commingling of bolts by grade in bins. This was verified by our logistics assistance reps when they found this to be the situation at all levels of supply and maintenance. Just plain unmarked bolts and evidence of a general lack of knowledge of bolt markings. And I must admit that I fall in that category as well. I have learned a lot in the last 2 weeks. Finally, muddying the issue, all too frequent maintenance malpractices, such as over and under torquing, sticking a bolt in not because it was a proper application, but because it fits, and even design mistakes that end up manifesting themselves as bolt problems when they're not. A prime example of this is the rebuilt T-142 track being used on the M60A3 at Fort Carson. To be frank, gentlemen, we did not do what you probably thought we'd do first: get the word out and police the battlefield. Well, the question is, what are we doing about it? We're not standing still. We have recently implemented an action plan to attack each of these issues. But prior to explaining that plan, I must note that we have to be a little careful. There is a very delicate balance that must be struck between readiness, safety, and good business practice. I think it would be counterproductive to cause false panic in the field. Keeping this in mind, there is no need to remove any bolts marked grade 8 or 8.2 from equipment unless they are located in critical areas and that particular lot of bolts had not undergone a proper test. Engineering analyses, testing, and field experience have concluded that grade 8.2 bolts perform satisfactorily on those systems. Now, this rationale is based on a combination of information from the field worldwide and the fact that in excess of 20,000 bolts have been tested by DISC, by AMCCOM, and TACOM, and over 1,100 samples have been tested for tensile strength, and the results show that 98.5% were rated at least at the 8.2 strength. The bottom line of those tests substantiate the continued use of those bolts found in the field with grade 8 or 8.2 markings. Now, let me emphasize that I am talking about our systems in situations which do not exceed 500 degrees Fahrenheit. The difference between the 8 and the 8.2 is not significant and are in fact equal in tensile strength. Mr. Raymond G. Kamer, the Deputy Director of the National Bureau of Standards, highlighted this point in a letter to you, Mr. Chairman, on the February 3, 1987, when he said, and I quote, that grade 8.2 will exhibit the same performance characteristics, in other words, strength, as grade 8 from room temperature to 650 degrees Fahrenheit, end quote. Well, now what we must do is to educate the field as to the proper inventory procedures. No commingling. The inadvertent mixing of grades must stop. And that, gentlemen, is not as simple as it appears. A look in the bins in your local hardware store will confirm that commingling is not just an Army problem. I went out this last Saturday to prove that particular statement to myself when I visited several automotive hardware stores and looked through their bins and found commingling at that place too. My boss, General Wagner, also did the same thing, and he found the same thing to be true. So it is not just an Army problem, it is a nationwide problem as well. At the same time, our maintenance people and their supervisors must know that there are different bolts and that their proper application is absolutely critical. More importantly, they must know what the consequences are if they don't. Now, this is going to require a major communication effort, and we have begun. We are reducing the confusion factor by identifying and separating all graded bolts by grade and placing them in separate bins that are properly labeled. We are also having all unmarked bolts, what I call slick heads, no markings at all, regraded or regarded as grade 2 and placed in appropriate bins. All bolts with the manufacturing logos of KS, H, and FM are considered unacceptable for general use and will be placed in controlled storage and used only if operational readiness is impacted. We're also closing the loophole in local purchase by curtailing all local purchase of bolts for critical applications. All critical applications will automatically require a certified by testing grade 8 bolt. We're developing a cogent, uniform policy to ensure that full spectrum testing is applied across the board by prime contractors. We will continue to do our own testing in our own laboratories. We have learned that integrity is not guaranteed by markings alone. We can no longer take it on faith. The basic thrust of our plan is a very simple fact of placing increased emphasis on the basic fundamentals of sound supply and maintenance operations. The common thread that indeed binds us together is the individual safety, especially ensuring the safety of the soldier who is willing to put his life on the line. The bolts which are counterfeit are an indictment of integrity, and it's a sad statement when trust is lost between industry and the military, which defends this great nation. I can assure you that in the Army, the problem has our attention. We are totally committed to providing the quality equipment, whether it's a bolt or a tank, to our soldier. And that commitment is to readiness, and readiness is our business. Sir, that concludes my opening statement, and we're ready for your questions.
Thank you for your very helpful statements. Chair will recognize members for questions. Chair will recognize first the distinguished gentleman from Oregon, Mr. Wyden, for questions.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Let me begin, if I might, with you, General McGrath. The subcommittee staff was told by DISC and Army officials that the Depot Systems Command sent the last DISC list of grade 8 fastener contracts that failed laboratory tests to the depots on April 28, 1988. Is that correct?
For the grade 8 bolt, yes, sir.
Okay. These DISC test lists were messages number 5 and 7 and covered 97 contracts and over 100 national stock numbers. The DISC messages were part of 13 messages that were sent between the summer of 1987 and the end of 1987. Isn't that correct?
They started in August, sir. I'm sorry, I don't know off the top of my head when they ended.
Okay. DISC message number 5 was sent in August 1987, and message 7 was sent in September 1987, according to what AMC told our subcommittee on Wednesday. The staff was also informed that while messages 5 and 7 were sent by DISC, for unknown reasons, they were not received by DESCOM last year. Isn't that correct?
To the best of my knowledge, sir, we never received messages 5 and 7.
So between August of last year and last week, Army depots were still issuing fasteners from lots that had failed DISC testing. Isn't that correct?
Sir, they would have issued the stock that matched the NSNs and contracts that were on messages 5 and 7, yes, sir.
So Army depots were still issuing fasteners from the lots that had failed DISC testing?
Not all my depots had those, sir, but the ones that did would have shipped it.
All right. Now, DISC issued 13 messages numbered 1 through 13. DESCOM received numbers 1 through 4, number 6, and numbers 8 through 13. Isn't that correct?
Yes, sir.
See whether DESCOM is counting properly in this situation. If DESCOM received all the other numbered messages in the sequence, could you tell us why DESCOM didn't realize that the two were missing?
Sir, I wish history and resurrected. We have an oversight on our part. We screwed up, and we should have done it.
Stating it, I was just flabbergasted that y'all weren't counting right, and I think that was what particularly concerned us. When is the when is the DESCOM system going to have all their stocks at depots purged?
Sir. We just sent out, as you stated, DISC messages 5 and 7. My depots have a tasker to have all stocks purged by the 13th of May.
How long do you believe it will be before the end users in the field have 100% tested grade 8 fasteners in their inventories?
Sir, I don't think I can comment on that since I don't buy them. All I do is ship that which is sent to me by DLA.
Could any of our panel members answer that? I mean, my concern, based on what you've said, is that some of these parts could be around for years at this point.
Sir, if I may address that question in general terms, not in specific terms, the thrust is to utilize the bolts that I spoke of in my testimony
to tide us over until the new stocks become available. That may be a period of a few months. I don't know whether General Pagotti could give us some idea as to when we'd be able to replenish the total stocks out in the field or not.
Mr. Pieger?
We're currently getting receipts of contracts that are testing out 100% good. Those contracts are the result of buying activity late last summer. I think we'll see the large influx from those buying activities last summer this summer. So our wholesale stocks should be on, well on the way to replenishment July-August timeframe. It depends on the manufacturer's ability to react to the large number of contracts we put in last year.
Mr. Chairman, I wanted to ask one other set of questions for the folks at DISC with respect to the Class 3 threaded bolts. My concern here is that DISC is essentially going through the same exercise on Class 3 threaded fasteners that DISC went through on Grade 8. DISC is sending messages to the services that provided contract numbers and national stock numbers. The first message was dated January 11, 1988, with again a message to purge the stocks. Considering the earlier testimony of August 5, 1987, why has it taken DISC so long to initiate this process?
It's a much bigger problem. The Class 3 threaded fasteners is 100 times as big as the Grade 8 problem. And as we testified last year, our approach to that problem was to try to scope the problem into manageable, workable elements. Now, we've been working closely with the services and are attempting to identify the safety-critical Class 3 threaded fasteners. Those safety-critical fasteners are being frozen, as we did with Grade 8, tested by very precise methods, and then cleaned up. But the whole magnitude of the inventory is so large, it just is going to take longer.
The reason I'm so concerned about these Class 3 threaded materials is that, by your own admission, they're safety critical, and I'm still not certain what the Air Force's position is. Are they purging right now? Are they testing? Are they using the existing stocks? Because this is such an enormous problem, I'd like to know exactly what the Air Force is doing.
On the Class 3 fasteners as opposed to the Grade 8, on the Class 3 fasteners, the Air Force has identified 29 stock numbers that are safety critical. Those 29 stock numbers had been frozen. They are being tested. The Air Force, to the best of my knowledge, is purging those.
Well, I know my time has expired, but maybe you could tell us on these Class 3 threads, are the field inventories now being segregated by use so that we know that they're not getting into toolboxes on a daily basis?
I can't speak to that. We are informing the services of what our findings are on the safety critical Class 3 fasteners. Each service has identified a number of stock numbers, a rather small percentage of the total population, and we are working those problems. Now, how the services are perpetuating that information, I've got to believe we've been learning from the Grade 8 experience, but I can't speak to the details.
Sir, could I have a shot at that for
sure.
A moment? I would tell you that given your concerns in this regard, both in your statement as well as the questions, since I guess I'm the senior guy here, I'll take it on a part of the Defense Department to get with the Air Force and get you some responses.
Well, Mr. Chairman, I think that that is helpful, but given the fact that the testimony today indicates that these Class 3 threads are 100 times the problem of the Class 8s, and given the problems we've seen with the Class 8s, I think it's absolutely essential that we find out whether we're seeing these field inventories segregated by use. And Mr. Chairman, I would like to pursue this with you further, because I think given the fact these are safety critical materials by the testimony today, that just must be done immediately.
The chair agrees with the gentleman. The chair
Chair observes that this morning, because of the complexity of the question, in order to afford both the members and the witnesses adequate time to deal with the questions the subcommittee has, we've extended the time to 10 minutes for each member. The gentleman from Oregon's had 10 minutes. The chair will now recognize the gentleman from Ohio, Mr. Oxley, for 10 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'd like to ask, I guess we'll start with General Russo, and then you could refer the questions to any of the members of the panel that you feel is appropriate. I'd like to ask you some questions about the M1 Abrams tank. As you know, one of the assembly factories for that tank is located in Lima, Ohio, in my district. We've heard some distressing testimony this morning concerning problems with fastener failures in tracked vehicles. Has the Army had any problems with fasteners in the M1 tank that adversely affect the reliability of that tank?
Sir, I'm going to pass that to General Flynn. He is the commander of the tank automotive.
Thank you.
At this point in time, the answer is no, sir, it has not. We have very good OR rates in the field with the M1, A1. We're about the 94-95% level right now.
General Flynn, does the Army have any reason to believe that the M1 tank is presently unable to fulfill its mission because of fastener problems?
Absolutely not, sir.
The M1 tank has been in service for about 6 years. Have tanks delivered to the Army since the first alert was sounded in the autumn of 1986 had more fastener-related problems than tanks delivered prior to that time?
Can't really answer prior to that time, sir. I can talk about since the last year, for example, our attention level has gone up considerably. We have found, and General Dynamics has found, fasteners, problems with fasteners in their plant. But it's as a result, when you look hard, you find more things. And that's about where we are right now.
But you do feel satisfied that currently they're in fairly good shape?
Yes, sir.
Has the Army been satisfied with the efforts that General Dynamics made to remove questionable bolts from its inventory?
I'd say that satisfied with the result, but maybe a little bit too slow.
And has that pace accelerated recently, or has it been a...
It has accelerated to a great degree, sir.
And would you...
All our attention levels has gone up significantly.
And why is that, General?
Well, right now, sir, we're in a situation where we have accepted a couple of waivers, and we have another waiver ongoing, and we're looking closely, they're looking closely, and just the attention level has risen.
Let's consider the nature of the bolts on the M1 tank. Is it true that the critical applications, such as main gun recoil mechanism, General Dynamics has its own specifications and buys its own bolts made to those specifications?
That's correct.
Is it true that the problem...
Excuse me, sir. In the Army's technical data package, we also point out the specific specifications, such as a grade 8 bolt.
And that is different from the M60 in that regard?
No, sir, I don't believe so.
So they're treated the same?
Yes, sir. Maybe I can... Thank you.
Sir, on the weapon systems, the control is by our Armaments Command. And there are special numbers on those bolts, and they are procured by the Army, and they are tested by the Army, sir.
Okay.
They're generally grade 9 bolts, sir.
Is it true that the problem that this subcommittee has been considering would not affect those specially designed bolts?
Yes, sir, I believe that's true.
I understand that the problems that General Dynamics had with bolts lay in the use of grade 8.2 bolts where grade 8 bolts were called for. Would you please describe the difference between a grade 8 and a grade 8.2 bolt and tell us what the difference, when the difference becomes significant?
I'd like to pass on to Mr. Barnett to answer that question.
The main difference between a grade 8 and an 8.2 is essentially first chemical composition. There's less carbon in an 8.2 than in a grade 8. And the other major difference, the 8.2 has traces of boron in to cause it to be hardened. Thirdly, the thing we look at is the temperature at which it is tempered. A grade 8.2 is tempered at 650 degrees, a grade 8 at 800 degrees, so that if you're operating, and we've used the figure 500 degrees, or above, you should use a grade 8. under 500 degrees using either one.
So am I correct in stating then, as long as the temperature remains below 500 degrees, that, and apparently General Russo made reference to this in his testimony, that there's not really that much difference between an 8-point and an 8.2?
That's right, assuming that they're both manufactured to spec.
Was it on that basis that the government granted a waiver to accept M1 tanks, even though there is a possibility that some bolts that were supposed to be grade 8s were actually 8.2? General Flynn?
Yes, sir.
Would you describe for us the terms of the waiver that was granted to General Dynamics for the tanks that were produced in March of 1988?
Yes, sir. We basically had a lot of 185 tanks for March, April, and May. We took a look at the March tanks. There was 68 tanks involved. We were talking about 51 different locations on the tank. 39 of those were visible, 12 were not visible. When you talk about 68 tanks times 39, you had basically 2,652 positions that were visible. We inspected all those positions, and we found that there were suspect logos on 32 of them. When we say suspect logos, General Dynamics has a list of the logos that they consider that they would use, and there's only 18 of them. They've looked very, very closely on which 18 they're going to use in their plant. When you take the probability, they came out with 32 suspect logos over the 2,652, and you came up with a probability or an actual having suspect logos for 1.21% of those particular locations. You take that same rationale and you take a look at the 12 inaccessible locations that we're talking about. Multiplying the 12 times 68 tanks, you get 816 total positions that you have that are now inaccessible. You take a look at the 816 by times 1.21% probability, and you come out to a total of approximately 10 bolts on 68 tanks. Now, we're not saying 10 bad bolts on 68 tanks. We're talking about 10 suspect bolts on 68 tanks. Now, to address the problem of suspect bolts, then you have to take a look and see what GD did then. What they did was, in addition to the 2,652 bolts that were on the tanks, they went to the bins and they physically inspected and tested, they inspected about over 70,000 additional bolts. So we're talking about inspecting 70,000 additional bolts. They came up with a total of 768 total suspect bolts. That includes the 32 that were on the tank and the balance were in the bins. Of those 768 total suspect bolts, 127 were grade 8 and 641 were grade 8.2. That's the grand total of 768 total suspect bolts. They were all tested. We found out nothing else but 8 and 8.2. When you go back to the original premise that we were accepting 8.2s, those bolts that were marked 8, but in fact tested 8.2, then I had the decision to make on that particular waiver. Do I leave those bolts in the tank, or do I take the tank apart? And based on these percentages and probabilities, and the fact it would cost about $200,000, not to the government, but to General Dynamics, I approved the waiver and accepted those particular bolts in the 12 locations where we're not accessible. At the same time, added a little insurance clause, which basically said, if upon completion, we had not completed all that testing I indicated at that particular time. I told them at that time, if in fact, upon completion of the testing, they did not all prove out to be in those two categories I mentioned earlier, they would in fact take the tanks apart. In fact, the test proved out, like I said, we did not take them apart. That was the decision I had to make, and I did it.
What other agreements did you make with General Dynamics? Was General Dynamics subjected to any kind of a rebate back to the government, or what kind of arrangement did you make?
We received $23,000, sir.
And that was an agreement between, why of $23,000?
That was a negotiation between one of my assistant contracting officers and the contracting people at GD. They came up with a number of $23,850, of which, sir, I don't know where that number came from.
Did they make any guarantees for what might happen in the future? Did General Dynamics make any kind of an agreement with you as to how they would proceed in the future as far as quality of the bolts and the standards?
They tightened up their whole quality procedures, and they've been doing it as they go along. But like I said originally, a little bit too slow as far as I'm concerned. But they were doing it. Their attention was at a very high level.
Was it you within the Army or the DOD that agreed to accept the waiver?
I accepted the waiver.
The buck stopped with you?
My decision.
Okay.
I've been rolling around in my bed thinking about it ever since.
Is the Army satisfied with the terms of the waiver granted to General Dynamics?
On that particular waiver?
Yes.
In retrospect, I might have tried to pop them for a few more dollars, sir. And the reason why is that at that time you start talking about we have purged. And I wasn't smart enough at the time to ask the second and third tier questions like, exactly what do you mean by a purge? And what, now I'm smarter, and in the second and third tier question I didn't ask, the purge did not include a complete emptying out of the bins at that time. What we are talking about, where you put your hand in the bin and you do some sampling. Could miss something down at the bottom, or you could not open it up, empty it out completely. That's where I personally think I made a mistake on that particular one. I learned a little better on each one.
Now, these negotiations are ongoing in terms of waivers. The waivers are good for what, 30 days?
Well, we have, it's by batch of tanks, sir.
Okay.
I accepted that waiver. Now we have another waiver, which we're currently negotiating. I really can't talk about the terms of that negotiation right now.
If I could just, yeah, thank you, Mr. Chairman. So that would be, the negotiations are for the April group of tanks, is that correct?
I think we're, I'm not sure if it's April, May, and June. I'm sorry, I just don't have that.
Okay. Suffice it to say then that the negotiations that you're involved in now, that you are indeed a wiser and more erudite general than you were perhaps earlier on in the waiver process?
The pucker factor has risen significantly, sir.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Sure, thanks, gentlemen. Gentleman from Ohio, Mr. Eckert.
Thank the chairman and thank the witnesses for joining us this morning. It's my understanding that that DISC froze its grade 8 stock in June of 1987 and that the Depot Systems Command notified Depots on September 10th of 87. Could someone indicate to me why there was a delay of the several months?
I'm sorry, sir, I didn't hear all your question.
It's my understanding that DISC froze the stock of grade 8s in June of 87, but did not notify Army depots to begin purging until September of 87. Is there a reason for the delay?
From the time we froze the stock at DISC to the time we identified which contracts were suspect is the reason for that time lag. What we had to do was to pull up all of our contracts that we had. We had to identify which depots they were at. We had to publish instructions on sampling those contracts. We had to send the samples to a lab.
General, could I excuse you for a minute? Could I just have somebody close that back door, Mr. Chairman? You're competing with the tour guide, General, and and while I'm sure their message for the visitors is interesting, it's confusing for all of us here. Please proceed.
Then we had to get results back from our labs and broadcast those contract numbers out to the depot. So the time lag in there was for us to get a handle on that problem and the status of our inventory.
Did the Army Material Command notify the various posts, camps, and individual stations of the problems and also order a purge at that level as well?
They did not, as far as the post camps and stations. What went out at that point in time was a message to our major subordinate commands, and these are commands such as the Tank Automotive Command, the AMCCOM, MICOM, things of that nature, to include the Depot Systems Command. We did not send a message to the field, to the individual soldiers, or the post camps and stations, or to the units. It has not been until this past week that a message of that nature that has gone out. It has now gone to all of the major commands, all the subordinate commands within those MACOMs, to include all of the supply maintenance personnel worldwide, to include notification of our Security Assistance Command, and they in turn will be working with our foreign military sales with our allies.
General, if I may ask for you to explain the logic about, similar to the question that I just asked, between September and now May, for the order to go to the various posts, in effect, I guess, leaving some of the field troops out there kind of on their own.
The approach that was taken, Mr. Eckert, was the fact that as we tried to approach this subject at that point in time, we know a lot more now than we did then, of course, was to go in and cut off the source of supply. I attacked the wholesale department. That's where DLA and DISC in particular took that action. With our Depot Systems Command, that's also our source of wholesale supply. That was the approach that was taken at that point in time. The test results were emerging from our laboratories at that time, as well as some of our major subordinates commands of AMCCOM and TACOM. And in that was showing that the test results were showing, to include the DLA test, that based on in excess of 20,000 samples that had been taken, that the bolts that were marked were, in essence, at least of the 8.2 tensile strength, i.e. 150,000 pounds per square inch. That would suffice, because that is the same requirement for the 8.0 bolt. And we discussed earlier the difference between the 8 and the 8.2. And so rather than go to the field at that point in time, we elected not to do that, to try to clean up the wholesale side. We're much smarter today. We find in retrospect that we should have done that simultaneously. We have now done that. And all I can say is that we have learned a lesson the hard way in that respect, and we are correcting it, and we are moving out smartly in that direction.
Can you advise this committee what has been done with the non-conforming material as a result of the purges?
The non-conforming material, the instructions to the field on that are, if you have non-conforming material, call DISC or send us a form so telling us. DISC will provide disposition. So if you take the whole stream of inventory, the stuff at the wholesale level, what we had in DISC depots, let's start with that. That's been segregated off, put in a non-issuable condition code, and is being held for evidence mainly. But that's the vast majority of the stock. All other activities who have material to turn in, when they ask us for disposition instructions, we will direct those turn-ins to a defense depot close to them. Now there is some that is unidentified, unmarked, retail level stock. We're sending all that to Columbus. Europe is being told to send their stuff to Columbus. So we've got instructions out, and if anyone has any questions, they can call us, and we'll direct the non-conformers.
Did DESCOM purge all the contracts of grade eights, or did they only review the contracts that had failed DISC testing?
Sir, we purged our stocks and are in the process of purging them right now on all the contract numbers and all the NSNs that were listed in the DISC messages.
Did the failing to purge stocks that had been shipped by DISC before the testing program began would still have the effect of having non-conforming fasteners at levels below the depot?
Sir, we would still be shipping NSNs and grade 8 bolts, or grade 8.2, if in fact they were, that were not listed on the DISC messages, yes, we would be doing that.
General Pagotti, is that the correct pronunciation?
Yes,
I want to make sure I get that correct. We went through a whole hearing several weeks ago and totally mispronounced someone's name until they kindly sent us a note about an hour or so into it. And no, that's never pleasant for anybody, so General, I want to make sure I get that right. A disc message to DESCOM and AMC on September 2nd, 87 states, the Grade 8 system freezes has had a major negative impact on weapon system supply availability, particularly for land combat systems. That's a quote. Is the Army still experiencing this?
From the standpoint of supply support, there is still an adverse impact. Historically, in that stock class that the bolts fall into, stock class 5305, we have been able to supply about 90% of the requisitions first time full filled.
Of a quality bolt that meets specifications?
Yes. Now, 90%, that's been our historical average. At the worst of the grade 8 problem, when everything was frozen and our buy arounds were still materializing, that had fallen to 78%. We were now able to only fill 78% of the Army's requisitions, first time full fill. Today we're up to 84%. So from our perspective, we had not been able to provide the kind of support that historically we had been able to.
Can I ask you to characterize what these percentages mean to you in terms of readiness, in terms of training, in terms of all the appropriate regimens that today's Army must be prepared to meet? Do we have less tanks that are capable of training? Do we have less?
A direct correlation between wholesale supply availability, whether it's DISC or AMC or Air Force or Navy or anywhere. I know of no direct correlation that's ever been made between supply availability and readiness rates. I just don't know of those correlations. But if we then look at the number of back orders we have against the system, we've seen that grow dramatically. So the message to me is, the troops who use the equipment are having a harder time of it because of this problem. It's just an intuitive judgment, and I've got no reason to believe otherwise. Our back orders normally are 3,000. They were up to 26,000 at the height of this thing. So we have not been providing the supplies that the troops normally would expect to get in this stock class of 5305.
Thank you, and I thank the chairman.
The time of the gentleman has expired. Gentleman from Virginia, Mr. Pratt.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. General Pagotti, I understand that after DISC had tested about 1,500 of the contracts and had found a 29% non-compliance rate in those 1,500 contracts that were tested, that DISC then issued a statement that it was going to test all 100% of the contracts to be supplied from that time on. And at the time that that statement was made, this subcommittee was told that there were about 440 contracts for grade 8 bolts that were due at that time to be shipped to DISC. Now, at the time that statement was made and the contractors realized that there was going to be total testing on all contracts from that time forward, did you have contractors who backed down, those who at that time decided not to ship their parts after all?
Yes.
Can you tell me how many there were?
We had 85 contracts or purchase orders. We had 85 purchase orders that contractors decided not to fill
It seems to me that in view of that fact, roughly 85 out of 440 contractors decided not to fulfill their obligation based on the fact that they knew the testing would take place, that there is quite a message there as to the value of testing, and perhaps a message as to the kind of vendors that you were dealing with as well. General, last August, you testified that more than 80% of your grade 8 inventory had been plated with zinc as opposed to cadmium, and cadmium was the coating that was specified in the contract. and on that basis alone, that the government had overpaid $228,000. You further testified that DISC was going to pursue the recovery of that $228,000. Can you tell us how you've done with that and how much of that amount has been recovered?
Before we can pursue that recovery, those contracts have to be released to us by the Defense Criminal Investigative Service and the Department of Justice. The big dollars yet to be recovered are tied up in those cases either under investigation or being prepared to come to trial. So we're left with some very small contracts. Right now, the biggest recovery that we have of those that we have control over that have been released to us is for $2,617. We have sent a letter to a contractor saying, what you owe us is this much, send us a check. I expect the response to those Dunn letters will be probably favorable, and the community will be willing to write that off. But we're still talking small contracts, small recoveries, because the big bucks are in litigation.
Well, here we are some 9 months after the statement was made that you were going to pursue this recovery, and out of $228,000, you've recovered only about 1% of that. It seems to me that
I can't go after the rest, sir.
No.
I can't go after the big bucks until those contractors are released to me by the U.S. Attorney's Office. I can't pursue consideration until they get finished with their court action, whatever that's going to be.
All right. I think we can accept that explanation. Could you supply to us a list of the outstanding claims that you presently have by dollar amount and by contractor?
Okay.
Good. Can we make the assumption that all of the 30 million non-conforming grade 8 bolts were received from the 49 contractors that presently appear on the DISC contractor review list?
The large part. There may be some that had been on our contractor review list before we got into the height of the grade 8 actions, but by and large I'd have to say yes. Those 49 comprise.
I note that of those 49 contractors who you have determined supplied non-conforming items, that as of this point in time only 3 of those have been disbarred. And I wonder if you could give us some information as to why there has been such a lengthy period of time and only 3 of those have been debarred to date.
That activity has been one that has gained momentum. Now, granted, there are only 3 that have been debarred, but there are more that have been proposed for debarment, and the contractor has been asked to show cause why they shouldn't be debarred. There are more over that who have been recommended for debarment. Right now, the DLA has 27 different companies or individuals at some point of the debarment process. So I think you'll see that start to roll.
So you are pursuing the others, but...
Yes, I think it's to an unprecedented level.
Well, to the casual observer, that still seems like rather slow action, given the problems that we faced and the very large number of suppliers who have been found to have contributed non-complying bolts. Let me ask you about...
Sir, could I add a piece to that?
Yes, General Russo.
My staff is the debarring official, so I can't leave that all in General Pagotti's hands, and so I've got to get a little bit of the tar that you may want to send out. There's a little history here. When I came on board in 1986, the agency had essentially 2 folks working in that debarment office. About a year or so ago, actually in the January-February timeframe, we were hit pretty significantly with some indictments up in Philadelphia in our clothing and textile world. I must tell you that overall, under my predecessor, continuing under my tenure, we've put a lot of heat into the bar area. And just to give you a number, since 1983, we've risen from 150 debar actions to where today we're at over 300 actions per year. So correspondingly then, we needed to build that office up. We have it up about three times what we had it 18 months ago. And so part of that has also been the growth in the staff to handle the totality of the debar suspension actions that we're faced with. And Leo's piece of that is relatively small, important, but it's been a matter of workload and staffing up that particular function.
Right. I wish we had thank done you, it faster. Thank you for that explanation. Let me ask you, if I may, about your efforts with regard to one specific contractor. And these were efforts to discipline Highland Bolt and Nut Company, which is a subsidiary of the MNP Corporation. The records that our subcommittee has reflect that between 1982 and 1986, they provided you with defective grade 8 bolts under 16 separate contracts. They also had produced non-conforming materials for other distributors who supplied them to DISC under other contracts. So this number of 16 is a minimum. I noticed that in your testimony, where you have given this history, you had awarded 10 contracts to Highland in recent months. Now, while the material that is provided under those contracts recently awarded may be conforming, how do you ever expect contractors to police themselves if they perceive, based on these recent awards to Highland, that there's not going to be any penalty for supplying non-conforming items?
Highland is a case not unlike others. Although there is a unique aspect to Highland. You know, we've been saying that this is a dealer problem and an importer problem. Highland is a division of a small manufacturer. So you see, this problem goes even to our manufacturing base in this country. Our problem with Highland was one of what we termed as integrity. They had provided us non-conforming materials, and we had elected to find them non-responsible in the December timeframe for contractor integrity. Being that they're a small business, we then have to refer that to the Small Business Administration. The Small Business Administration found Highland to be capable of fulfilling the contract, and got into negotiations with us about the integrity issue.
Well, let me just anticipate.
We went through that for about 6 months, and the bottom line is we were instructed to award to Highland on those.
Well, I beg to differ with you on the facts of your dealings with the SBA. As a matter of fact, there is a letter from the SBA to the DISC, which says as follows. It begins with this preamble. It says, "This is to confirm the telephone conversation of March 9, 1988, wherein you indicated that your agency would not protest the issuance of this COC. So it appears that you acquiesced in the determination by the SBA that this contractor was perfectly qualified to supply bolts."
And that statement really doesn't reflect what happened,
sir.
Our negotiations with the SBA led us to believe that this contractor would be found non-responsible. The discussion centered around integrity versus tenacity versus perseverance, and we were under the impression that those COCs would not be issued. And so that statement does not reflect the true situation. Now, granted, we have the recourse to appeal a COC to higher authority. That's a very difficult and a very time-consuming proposition. And in this case, given that the way we sized up the situation, we accepted the COC. But the COC overrode our finding of non-responsibility.
Well, it would seem to me that there are two problems here. First of all, there is the statement by the Small Business Administration, whether you agree with the statement or not,
right,
that DISC acquiesced in this finding of the qualification of the contractor. And secondly, given the very severe problems that we've had in this area and a series of hearings where you and others have appeared before this subcommittee to answer those concerns, it would appear to me that that an appeal of this decision might well have been appropriate. Somehow or other, there simply has to be a message sent to the contractors that there will be a penalty for their continued supplying of non-conforming items.
I agree with you 100%, sir. And when six contracts are referred and six contracts come back with our decision overridden, and then two more, sometimes at the buyer level, you know, there's an old saying, when you stop beating your head against the wall, it feels pretty good. At sometimes at the buyer level, there is a tendency to give up. We don't you know, condone that. But I might add, on Highland, we're proceeding with debarment activities against that company.
All right. Thank you very much. My time has expired.
You mentioned that there were six instances in which the determination of your agency was overridden. Is that correct, by the Small Business Administration?
There's eight.
Eight?
On that one company, on Highland Bolts.
On that one company, Highland Bolts. Would you provide the committee with the correspondence on the override in each instance, please?
Certainly.
Could you tell us, please, General, were there other overrides in connection with other companies, in connection with other shipments and other contracts?
I can't give you detail at this point.
No, I understand that.
In general, the Small Business Administration does inject themselves into these. We have to refer things, and a percentage of time, which I can't give you an exact percentage, but a number of times the companies are found to be responsible. And I must say, more often than not, the company then delivers.
You're telling me, though, that more often than not, the company then delivers. But that still means that in a good percentage of the time, the company cannot and does not deliver.
A percentage of the time, it will prove to be a problem.
Now, the chair was in the impression that this is the only instance in which SBA had attempted to overrule a DISC in a grade 8 bolt matter. And when their general counsel, Walter Pierce, testified about SBA problems on other contracts, the subcommittee sent GAO to Philadelphia to get concrete examples, and Mr. Pierce was unable to provide a single example. Now,
that may be true in grade 8.
Grade 8s.
That may be true in grade 8. I took your question in a general sense on certificates of conformance and dealings with small business.
Well, if SBA is overriding determinations of defense with regard to capability and the integrity of contractors under the small business set-aside, and that action is not fully justified, and supply integrity and the integrity of equipment at the defense logistics agencies is being adversely affected, I think that this is something that should be known, so that either SBA can correct its business or the Congress can deal with the matter through appropriate legislative action.
Well, from the SBA perspective, it can be shown that in Highland Nut and Bolt, the deliveries they are currently making are passing our inspections.
They are now passing.
They are now passing.
Were they passing before?
Highland Nut and Bolt provided us non-conforming. No, they did not pass
before. The bolts before did not conform.
Correct. But you see, the Small Business Administration has a different side to the thing. They'll point out that past performance is one thing, but potential to perform is equally important. And the decisions that I see coming from small business oftentimes show that they believe the contractor will perform subsequent for the time in question.
If I were a tanker in combat or with the potential of it before me, I'm not sure I'd have the same kindness towards a supplier who has a record of not having complied with his contracts. I'm going to instruct the staff to be in touch with you about your instances on when SBA has overridden the Defense Department with regard to termination of suitability and the behavior of contractors. And I think that will be a very helpful inquiry. If there's bad behavior there, or if the security of the nation or the safety of military personnel or the adequacy of equipment is not being properly dealt with here, I think that the Congress and everybody else ought to know about it so the matter can be addressed.
Sir, could I put a postscript to
certainly,
that?
Certainly, General.
In our organization, we traditionally have been looking for folks who have been convicted of criminal action and that sort of thing before we debarred them. Of the totality of what we've been doing, maybe 20-25% get into the performance world. I must tell you that we have taken a pretty strong stance with regard to our commanders and their suppliers that in essence says, hey fellas, if you're not going to provide us with quality materials on time, we don't intend to do business with you any longer. So
I don't care whether it's St. Peter or
absolutely.
The devil that's doing the supplying. What I care about is what is the equipment that's being supplied. If St. Peter's giving you bad equipment, the devil's giving you good, you should
absolutely.
Do business with the devil.
I guess the only point I would make, sir, is that we have some other recourses to bypass, if you will, the SBA. That's a rule that says you got to go there for COC. But we're also looking harder, let's say, in these days, with regard to the bar action, which then the SBA really doesn't play a role in.
Very well, General. The committee thanks you for those comments. General, the commander of AMC issued a message to the field on May 5. That's Exhibit 9 in the committee's exhibits, which ordered the purging of fastener stocks at all levels. Under the theory of better late than never, the Army is, of course, to be commended for ordering the cleansing of fastener stocks at camps, posts, and stations. However well-intentioned that effort, I fear that the message contains some serious errors. Paragraph 5 of page 2 gives specific guidance on which fasteners are to be purged. It states all logos of KS, H, and FM are unacceptable for general use. That is excellent, and I think those are sound choices. There are other logos that could be added, such as RT, but again, we come back to this point. Subparagraph C of the document lists the bolts that are acceptable as long as they don't have the three unacceptable logos. There are three categories of acceptable bolts. The first acceptable category is those that contain a grade head marking. There is no mention of any manufacturer's logo here, General. Why do you believe that grade A bolts, which have a grade marking, but do not have a manufacturer's mark, as required by the SAE standard and the current DOD standard, are acceptable?
Sir, let me, if I may, address the why we selected the three manufacturers, and then I'll come
back. I think that's a good idea that you
yes.
did. I'm sure it's fully justified, and with you on that point.
Well, we took a look at the total tests that were conducted by DLA, and at a given point in time, we found that 50% of those that were non-conforming, that were 8.2s, were in fact comprised of those three companies, which gave us an indication that the manufacturing processes, procedures, and the emphasis being placed by the manufacturers were such that they were questionable, and consulting with your staff, that's why we elected that. Now, specifically to your question about those we make the comment in paragraph 5, Charlie 1, that says they contain a grade head marking and there's no mention of a manufacturing logo. If you go back into history and you find out how we label the bolts over a period of time, you will find that it has been a voluntary process, either through the Society of Automotive Engineers or through the Industrial Fastener Institute, and that has been a voluntary process by the manufacturers. There is nothing that is in law per se or by regulation up until about the July-August timeframe of last year. What has been utilized in the past has been what has been asked for on the tech data package or the contract that was signed by the government. It may very well call for a military specification, an MS, if you will. It, in some cases, does not call for a manufacturer's logo. And so that was the basis by which we did not say that it had to have a manufacturer's logo.
Well, let's look at the result of some of the testings that the Defense Department has done. We look at the pass-fail rate of FM and KS. Those are two that your agency has determined should not. In the case of FM, in 19 passed and 76 failed. In the case of KM, 3 passed and 95 failed. In the case of bolts with no head stamp, no manufacturer's head stamp, you had 150 pass and 121 failed. You had a 50% failure on those. In H's, where H goes, H is one of the three, you had 13 pass and 126 fail. You had some where you have unknown or illegible, you had 45 pass and 121 fail. That's again about a 50-50 failure rate, or 60-40 maybe if you're on the generous side.
Yes, sir.
Why would a bolt which has a failure rate of 121 and a pass of 150, or of 45 and 40, with a higher number being the pass as opposed to fail, not be banned also from the supply system and from distribution?
I would not argue that statement, Mr. Chairman. In our discussion with members of your staff, we were really addressing five particular manufacturers at that point in time. The other two in question at that time were those that were labeled A and RT. And we took a look at the samples that we had in there, and I might emphasize that fail indicates that they were at an 8.2 level. They did not fail per se.
Well, I know total tensile your strength. Figures tell us with regard to A that one passed and 11 failed.
That's correct.
Are we to assume that is not correct?
That is the information that was provided by DISC.
Okay.
It's where do you draw the line?
Well, it doesn't look like A ought to get into tanks either, does it? I'm not sure I'd want to be in a turret when you had bolts that failed and you fired the main battery gun.
Emphasize that these are not located in what we call the critical areas, which are the gun mounts, the recoil mechanisms, things of that nature. Those are the critical areas that I spoke of earlier, and that's where we have certified type testing of bolts that will go in that particular area.
Well, let me refer to a document from the Office of the Assistant Secretary of Defense dated 20 April 1987. Let me just read a portion of the memorandum, and I'll assert the entirety of it in the record. It said, therefore, all our specifications and standards, i.e. federal military and DOD, adopted non-government standards, and any other DOT item descriptions used to procure industrial fasteners, nuts, bolts, and large screws within the standard industrial classifications of 3452 need to be revised to require manufacturers' identification markings. And the reason that they came to that judgment was they said here, results of surveys by the Defense Logistics Agencies and the Industrial Fasteners Institute indicate that non-conforming industrial fasteners are entering the DOD supply system. To the extent that these fasteners are purchased to non-government standards, the private sector is reacting by incorporating appropriate language in their standards to require manufacturers' identification markings and traceability. DOD currently requires manufacturers' identification markings on fasteners intended for aerospace applications, but such marking is not required by the specifications and standards we use to procure industrial fasteners. Then you come down to the paragraph that I read earlier. Your practice with regard to illegible, unknown, and unmarked with regard to manufacturer's markings indicates to me that your action is not in conformity with the letter from Mr. John A. Matino, Deputy Assistant Secretary for Production Support.
Sir, I may have to ask General Pagotti to help me on this, but I believe effective last July-August timeframe, any contract that was let from that point on, they required a manufacturer's logo be on it.
That's correct. We've written that into our contracts as of last summer.
And what we're referring to here, sir, is those bolts that were manufactured considerably earlier than that period of time and had been received and are, in fact, in the stocks that are out there in the field.
Well, here we've got ones that we have shown have failed their testing. If I look at illegible, 45 passed and 40 failed. If I look at no head stamps, 150 passed and 121 failed in your sample testing. Now, in each instance, your failure rate approximates 50%.
Sir, let me, if I may, quantify what fail means in this terminology. The fail column that you're looking at on that piece of paper is that the bolt tested out at 8.2, not 8.0. It was marked 8.0 and actually tested out at 8.2, and that is disc testing. Perhaps General Pagotti can verify that.
Yeah. Well, if it is 8.2s are good, why are you not just simply procuring 8.2 and saving the taxpayers' money?
The specification that we had asked for in previous contracts was for an 8.0. And I think what we probably need to do is to capture what we're talking about in maybe three different bins, if you will. First of all, when we talk about nonconformance, substandard, or counterfeit, in the context that we're talking about today, that really is an essence as to what the contract called for and what was actually delivered. And in those cases where bolts were delivered that were not in conformance with the contract, they do, in fact, fall in the category of substandard, nonconformance, counterfeit, or in the failed category that we're talking about. What we're saying...
General, are these the only failures that you're referring to where they're testing out at 8.2 instead of 8.0s?
I believe that what we will find is that the $30 million that we have that are in storage by DLA or DISC right now fall in the category of 8.2.
What you have there are the number of contracts that have shown to be grade 8.2 in the number.
Are these 8.2 or are they 5.0 or what are they?
They're 8.2. They're 8.2 strength and composition.
Well, let me read some language here. This is in your testimony. Of 38 new shop stock bolts marked as grade 8.0, 21 were of grade 8.0, 14 were of grade 8.2, and 3 failed to meet requirements for either. Now, this is from Port Carson. This tells me that you had a 10% failure rate. Or maybe 9%, because you had 3 out of 38 that failed to meet any requirements, and 14 that were 8.2 instead of 8.0.
This is the Fort Carson.
Yeah.
Fort
this
Carson
is
sample.
Fort Carson, and I'm reading from your testimony.
The Fort Carson sample was a range of bolts. One bolt was marked grade 5. It tested at grade 5. A bolt was marked grade 2. It tested grade 2. There was one marked grade 1, and it tested grade 1. We were given 6 bolts that were supposed to be grade 8. One tested grade 8, 5 tested grade 8.2. So of the ones purported to be grade 8, they were either 8 or 8.2. The others were marked as other bolts, and they tested out as other bolts.
They were not marked then as being 8.0 or 8.2?
No, sir, they were not.
They were marked as being 5s or 2s or 1s?
They were marked as that, and that's what they tested out to be.
Why, gentlemen, I got two questions.
if these bolts don't need to meet the 8.0 test, why are we procuring 8.0 instead of 8.2? If they are at 8.2 good enough to serve our purposes, why are we melting down 30 tons of them? Or rather, 9 tons and 30 million of the bolts.
Hey, let me just talk to my previous comments now. My previous comments talk to samples given to us by DCIS from Fort Carson. I understand you also have information that were samples tested by the Army. So I'm not sure which set of bolts we're talking about here. But I know on the bolts provided to us for testing, that's the story as I gave it to you from Fort Carson.
Well, you're melting 30 million bolts, 9 tons down.
Okay.
Am I to assume from what you're telling me that you shouldn't be melting those bolts down, or that you should be melting those bolts down?
When we testified last year, our view of the problem was freeze everything and not reissue it, test it down. Now, we've had an evolving understanding of this thing, given the current service position. We'll have to relook at that. At this point, I think we've got to discuss the current service policies.
Hard fact of the matter is that you've got a lot of bolts in inventory. You've got a number of them that are headmarked that aren't meeting the tests that they should.
Right.
You've got a whole heck of a mess of bolts that you have to melt down because you can't risk them getting back into your inventory again. You've got people who've been delivering bolts that are either mismarked, don't meet the tests that they should, don't have proper prescribed head markings on, you've got a big problem, isn't that right?
But it's under control.
Well, that's with all respect, that's one of the things we're here to try to figure out, is it?
Yes, sir. The non-conforming bolts, we have segregated. Now, we can't dispose of anything for quite some time anyway because they're being held for evidence in the litigation.
You're telling me these are being set aside for use in possible criminal and civil actions by the United States
as evidence. But once that's done, then we're faced with how to dispose of those things. Right now, the DLA predisposition is we're going to smelt them and get rid of them. That's the way we're leaning right now.
Are you going to be using any of them?
I don't know.
Replacement?
I don't know. We've just seen the service position that talks to the acceptability of some grade 8.2 bolts. But I think the question of whether or not an 8 or an 8.2 is the desired bolt is something that's got to be looked at. I think the Army's current leaning is a grade 8 bolt is probably what we want, given that we have 8.2s in the system, we're going to use them up on selected logos. But we're able to do whatever the final decision and policy is. We've got them under control. They're segregated. They will not be issued unless we make a conscious decision to do so, and that's got to be worked out. Right now, we don't intend to issue any.
Well, it strikes me that your problem is not a small one, not one which you'd be comfortable with.
No, not at all.
If these tanks are shedding track bolts like ducks shed feathers, I think we got a real problem if it comes to shooting war. As a matter of fact, we may have some problems about killing some men in training when these vehicles start throwing their tracks. Gentlemen, let me just go on to some more questions here. Criteria number 2, as I read it, is also a problem in the communication. It states that bolts are acceptable if they can be traced to an original shipping container. Now, if no grade or head mark is required, and there are a number of bolts that are shipped to the Army, rather shipped into Army control by DISC before they started testing, and these untested bolts are still in inventory, can you tell me why these criticisms that I've been raising are incorrect or inadequate?
Sir, if I may address that particular point right in here is that when we talk about being able to trace to the original shipping container or the documentation is what we're after. If you can, in fact, verify the contract number and or the lot, depending on how that's looked at, you will be able to trace that back to determine whether that was, in fact, tested and whether it is a good bolt or not. And that is the rationale for putting that in that particular part of the...
Are all of these in original containers, or have they been placed in mixed containers? Are they all uniformly marked in these containers, or are they marked in different ways inside a single container?
Not necessarily the bolts and the bends. What we're talking about, some of those that are in the stocks at the post camps and station, they still have the contract number, or they're still in the shipping container. If you, in fact, know what that identification number is, then you can backtrack it, or it's traceable. It's the traceability is what we're after. If you can, in fact, verify that that was tested, then we will, and it is a good bolt, then we'll use it. Otherwise, we'll take it out of the inventory.
These could be bolts which are not tested and on which you have no knowledge as to whether the bolts are safe and adequate.
If they cannot be traced, then they would go over and probably be used as a grade two or discarded from the inventory.
But some of these bolts that you can trace are going to be bolts that you don't know is because you don't know whether they've been tested. Matter of fact, some have not, and you're not sure whether those which you don't know have been tested or which you know have not been tested can meet the government standards or the Army's standards. Is that right?
Sir, it would be a traceability aspect. You would backtrack it to the Depot Systems Command, who in turn would go back to DISC, and the messages that we talked about earlier would be able to tell you whether that stock number was in fact checked out.
You can tell me then that in each instance you're going to trace it back to testing the stock number? Or are you not going to trace it back to test the stock number?
If you can trace it back to a contract, we will be able to say how the testing on that contract went.
So you're going to tie testing to the contract?
To a contract. Now, if these are loose bolts and are not identifiable, then they will not be able to be traced back to a contract. And I understand they will either be used as grade two or turned into us for disposal.
But your communications to which I refer here doesn't say that they're traced back to some contract whose products have been tested. It just says you can trace it back to a contract. Do you understand the point I'm making?
Well, I think the Army thinking on that is the container contains a contract number. If you can trace it back to a contract, the implied message, I guess, is look at the list and see if the contract passed or failed.
How do the field troops have that list, and how do the field troops know about that?
How do the troops have the list?
Yes.
They do not have the list, but we will go back up through our logistics assistance channel, which as I spoke of a while ago, we've got about 1,200 of those scattered worldwide, and they'll come back up through the supply channels, working with the Depot Systems Command, and they in turn, if need be, will go all the way back to DISC to verify the stock number, and the bolts will not be used until such time as that's been verified.
Is that what the message says?
That is the implementing instructions that has been passed out to our logistics assistance representatives that are currently located out in the field, and they will be assisting each one of the units that are located worldwide.
That is not in this communication, though.
No, sir, that is not in that communication.
So you're saying that this communication is going to be perfected by subsequent communications?
The logistics assistance reps were already pre-warned and informed of the different things that they had to do in assisting the units prior to the release of this message.
Was that done in writing?
It is done in writing.
Would you submit that to the committee, please?
Yes, sir, I will.
Chair notes that the time the chair has expired, the chair has got to meet with the Attorney General. Would gentleman from Oregon take over and preside? Gentlemen, the committee thanks you, or I thank you personally. The committee will continue its business. Time the chair is expired.
Let us recognize the gentleman from Ohio for his questions.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Just, if I could, on my initial line of questioning, General Flynn, I understand that General Dynamics has made some changes in assuring that only quality bolts are used in the future M1 tank production. Could you help us with what kind of changes they've made and what you've recognized as being a hopefully a positive change?
Yes, sir. I'd like Mr. Bynett to address that. He's my quality assurance chief. He can be more specific.
That's fine.
What General Dynamics is in the process of doing as a result of their last purge identified a number of areas that need further attention. After having purged and got down to the 18 logos, they have placed those a copy of the logos all over their plant, and every worker in the tank plants at Detroit and Lima now are inspectors of sort to make sure that they keep their system policed, and I think that's important. Coming on down the line, the biggest thing I think that they're going to do is to narrow down their vendors to three, and by about August they'll be at that point where in place of buying from a number of manufacturers, it'll be down to three. And in addition, they're going to do something that I think is innovative. They're going to color code bolts. So it'll further make it easier for people on the line to ensure that bolts are good.
So they can require from their suppliers that the bolts be color coded?
Sir.
And they plan to do that in the contractual
that's part of the
arrangements?
The new plan, and also the amount of testing that they will do, an inspection, is going to be increased. The scheme that they used in the purge, and which they will continue to use, is what we call an AQL of 0.04%. And putting this in common terms, it means that they pull a rather large sample of incoming bolts and count that sample sample size is 315, for example. They will count and inspect each and every bolt to make sure that lot is homogeneous, and that finding one bolt which is not to the logo that they're buying, they reject the entire lot, and that lot then is rejected until such time as they make a determination that it's satisfactory and do 100% inspection. So there are a lot of checks and balances that they're now putting in to ensure that never again will they get the position where they find a few bolts here or there. The discipline is very good.
Thank you. Back to you, General Russo, if I can. General, in your testimony, you discussed recent problems at the Lima tank plant involving gas turbine engines produced by Textron Lycoming. When Textron Lycoming segregated the bolts into suspected conforming and suspected nonconforming, which were the head markings that were suspected to be nonconforming?
Sir, I don't have that level of detail here.
Could you supply that for
sir,
the... Mr. Chairman, I'd ask unanimous consent that information be made available to the committee.
Without objection, sir.
Thank you. General, I can I assume from your testimony that Textron Lycoming is now buying entirely from manufacturers directly, and that all of its subcontractors are now buying directly from U.S. manufacturers?
At Textron, the problem came up with some of their subcontractors, not for the bolts themselves, but the bolts that went into the components, two specific components or sub-assemblies. One is an all-tank assembly, and the other is an accessory gearbox. What they did was they went through down to the subcontractors and purged their inventories of the bolts that the subcontractors had in putting together those two particular components. And they have identified the types of bolt manufacturers that they want them to use in the future, which have been proven manufacturers. So I think that problem is under control.
Thank you. General Flynn, a final question. With regard to the 1,500 gas turbine engines currently being quarantined by Textron, Has TACOM decided whether or not to accept these engines with non-conforming bolts, that is, to grant another waiver?
Excuse me. I haven't seen that waiver yet. I understand it just arrived at TACOM yesterday. So we'll be evaluating it very similar to the third waiver we have at the tank plant.
And again, that will be your decision ultimately, General?
Yes, sir.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank the gentleman from Ohio. I want to pick up General Bunyard where Chairman Dingell left off. I am still puzzled about why you all don't get the message out that no bolts should be used other than those with the manufacturer's logo on them. We've got the letter from the Secretary of Defense directing that it should be done. We know that those bolts are the subject of criminal investigations, and yet for some reason you all seem to not wish to pursue it along those lines. The chairman went through the memorandum that says that you all make an exception for certain bolts that don't have the manufacturer's logo on them, and I am just puzzled why we wouldn't just throw out those bolts that don't have the manufacturer's logo if that's the Pentagon's policy.
Sir, I think we're caught in a period of time here where we have bolts in the inventory that were never required to have a specific logo on them based on the tech data package that was provided earlier on. We're not fighting the problem. We will cleanse the system as soon as the new bolts are made available, which will in fact have the manufacturer's logo on them. I indicated earlier that markings on bolts and the history of that, as you go back into it, some were never required to have markings on the bolts. Or the markings that were on there were such things as MS, military specification. Maybe they asked for that number that's on there. That is not a manufacturer's logo. Maybe it's the grade of steel that was on that bolt. Maybe that was what was asked to be on there. That is not a manufacturer's logo. There are some bolts that absolutely just do not give you the room to put a manufacturer's logo on there.
I guess I am still puzzled by this. The A bolts are failing. The NF bolts are failing. The RT bolts are failing, according to the statistics we have. And if you all are throwing out 30 million of them, why are you all saying that they should be used at this point?
Sir, they are not failing per se. They are 8.2 quality. And what we're saying is an 8.2 has the tensile strength and the capability that we desire to use in our systems. And the point being made on that column that says fail should be stated that it equal to 8.2, which is equal in strength under 500 degrees Fahrenheit.
I guess then I don't really understand why you all are throwing out the KS, FM, and the H's.
This was after considerable discussion with members of the staff that are sitting up there on the podium today at the point to where they felt that there were five contractor manufacturer logos that were suspect, KS, FM, and H, and RT and A, as I recall, were the five that were addressed last Wednesday when we discussed this with them. I went back in and reviewed the testing that was done in there, and I found that and those three, FM, KS, and H, was where we had about 52% of the non-conformance type bolts. If you go up and look at A as an alpha, you'll find that there were only 12 contracts that were tested. And RT was a total of 19. It is not the preponderance of bolts that you would find out in the field. What we have to keep in mind, Mr. Wyden, is that we have got to minimize the confusion and the disturbance and the panic that we would create out there in the field. This in itself right now is going to cause a lot of concern, a lot of effort, a lot of man hours will be put forth to trying to correct what we put out there right now.
Let me let the staff ask a question on this point.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. General, and we talked about this last week, as I recall, and I want you to confirm or deny this, please, that you said that you had decided to eliminate from the inventory those grade 8 bolts with no manufacturer's mark.
No, No, I did not.
Did you say that, or is that a wrong recollection on my part?
I did not say that.
Because if we had thought otherwise, we would have added that to the list as number one. Do you know of any manufacturer of grade 8 bolts in the United States that does not put their manufacturer's logo on the bolt?
If it is a domestic producer and they belong to the Industrial Fastener Institute or the American Society, Industrial Fastener Institute, they probably do. It's a voluntary basis right now.
But then we're making an exception for foreign manufacturers for these fasteners. And I think And they're not supposed to be any of those in stock anyway. I mean, this just becomes most curious to me, General, and I would just hope that you all would put out some kind of clarifying letter saying that your people are supposed to only use those with the manufacturer's logo. As the staff indicated, that was the impression that we were under, and I think that's what's in the interest of ensuring that our materials are safe as they need to be in the interest of our forces. Let me recognize my colleagues at this time for any additional questions. The gentleman from Ohio.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Barnett, Exhibit 7, a memorandum dated October 6, 1987. Paragraph 2 states, on a number of occasions, government and contractor personnel have requested a list of good and bad bolt manufacturers. In order to accommodate any future requests, a list of this nature will be developed and maintained by the AMSTA-QPOC, close quotes. Did such a list ever get compiled and distributed?
The answer is no. We started down that path, and we soon found that the number of logos and the duplicate logos is so tremendous that we thought we would confuse people. For example, the letter H, which we talked about, there's probably at least three or four producers that have the letter H. And it's so proliferated across the board that I felt we might mislead people. They might go the wrong direction. We've wrestled that problem, and we finally came to a solution recently. The commanding general of TACOM has directed our director of procurement to develop the contract clauses that we're going to put in all future contracts and those which have not been awarded, which will restrict people to use bolts that are certified with the ASME. And that's the same approach that the DLA is using. And before we finalize that, we obviously will coordinate in the AMC-DLA community. But that seems to be the best approach at the moment that we can come up with.
So the in-plant representatives never got a list telling them which head marks were acceptable and which
and
were
I,
not.
I tell you another reason why we didn't. The overall precept of quality is that contractors are responsible for their own vendor structure. They're responsible for the quality of the product that they obtained through that route. And as such, We laid it right back on contractors to develop that vendor structure. What has happened as a result of the pressure that we believe we put on our contractors? They have narrowed down on their own the vendor structure. And as I mentioned a while ago to Mr. Oxley's question, GD is going to go down to three. As I go through my list of our major contractors, a lot of them are down to three or four major producers. And to the best of my knowledge, I would estimate that it's almost 100% that it's being bought in North America. Bulk of it in the U.S., but a few use Canadian.
So are we kind of backing into a system of a registration, in effect?
I think we are, yes, sir. General Flynn, do you want to add to that?
Yes, sir. And I must admit why I signed that was that everybody and their brother has a different list. I know of no other way to get in the same sheet of music. I was heartened when I saw that DLA had done that. And I signed that thing yesterday. And as far as I'm concerned, somebody from above can tell me that's not the list, but everybody's got a list in their back pocket now. And we can't handle that. So we're going to put that in the contract terms.
Well, I don't think this person would object to it at this point. It would seem to me that it'd be very difficult for a depot person to really know which bolts were good and which were bad. Would it not then? I mean, is that correct or not?
Sir, there really isn't any difference when you look at them. You cannot tell an 8.0 from an 8.2 by looking at it. So the answer to your question is yes, it's very difficult.
So I guess is it a fair assessment, and I just want to try to draw a conclusion in this small area of questioning, that it is, given what is out there now, not what will come in the future, there was no way to tell for the in-plant quality inspectors and the depots as to which were good bolts or which were bad ones by a visual inspection?
Not by visual inspection, sir, but when I receive the bolts into my warehouses, they come in with a manufacturer's stamp on it, and I know the contract it comes in on. I store by national stock number. So if I know a contract or a national stock number, I can go to my storage, or go to my computer, will tell me where I'm storing it, and I can go check. And then if it's on the list of contracts or NSNs that are on the disk message, then I am segregating those bolts away from the rest of my stock.
Okay. Thank you. I thank the chairman.
Gentleman from Virginia.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. I'd like to return to an examination of the debarment process. We talked earlier about one of the firms you were seeking to debar, and let's look now at one that you did debar, the Morris Hardware Company. According to the debarment memorandum, and I quote, "Over the past decade, Morris Hardware has supplied the government with millions of dollars of nuts, bolts, screws, and other fasteners. The disc reports that it currently has more than $5 million in open contracts and purchase orders with Morris Hardware." Now, the date of that memorandum is March the 4th, 1988, and I understand that that is also the date on which Morris was disbarred. What is the status of that $5 million in open contracts and purchase orders? I would assume they've been terminated.
No, we need to look at those and hope he'll deliver. Morris was our fourth biggest supplier when this thing hit. We had a lot of contracts in being. I think we've got to look at each one and see what the delivery history is on it. And either terminate or request consideration for late delivery, he'll probably come through on some of those contracts.
Well, I would assume at the very least that you will inspect every one that comes forward.
Why? Sure.
You have made the decision to debar this particular contractor because of his past conduct. Given the fact that you have made that decision, why would you continue to allow him to sell to the government? Why don't you just terminate all of these contracts and seek that source elsewhere?
Well, we're seeking other sources. But if in fact we've invested the lead time in this contractor, and he can produce, and does produce, it's a savings.
Isn't there another consideration here, and that is the message that kind of conduct on your part, allowing him to continue to sell to the government, sends to other contractors, that they can perform badly, that they may even be debarred, but that they're going to be allowed to fulfill whatever contracts are in place at the time of debarment? I'm not sure that's a healthy signal to send. What do you think?
Well, I think the signal we're sending with our whole spectrum of activities is one of a get tough policy. I think we've got to look at each contractor and each set of deliveries as a business decision. We talked about the readiness impact in the field. If we terminate every non-conforming contract we currently have, we're going to have a bigger bubble in the pipeline than we now have. I think the message is out there when we see the results of our get tough clauses. 100% of what is now subject to inspection is conforming. And then we've had those people who defected and decided not to play because they, for whatever the reason, So I think the message is out there, sir. I think on selective contractors, we've got to just look at the volume involved and see what's best for the Army or best for all services.
Well, let's inquire a little bit further into just what kind of message is going to be sent as a result of this Morris Hardware disbarment. Your disbarment memorandum states that effective March the 4th, 1988, Morris is disbarred. But the disbarment only lasts until October 30th of 1990. It's a period of a little more than 2 years. Now, how effective is that as a deterrent? Why don't you just bar them forever?
I think that's a decision made by the debarring official based on the information available to that community. I think normally a debarment goes between 2 and 3 years.
Do you have the authority to disbar forever?
I don't know. I don't know.
Would you make that inquiry and answer by written document that question? Mr. Chairman, I would ask that the record remain open for that purpose. It would be nice to know what authority, in fact, you have in terms of the length of disbarment. Now, also on page 10 of that same memorandum, it states that the debarment applies only to the supplying of fasteners in federal supply classes 5305 and 5306. Can you tell me what those classes are?
Predominantly grade 8 bolts. The grade 8 bolts fall into those two classes.
So even though Morris Hardware has been debarred because of its failure to supply conforming grade 8 bolts, it would be free to supply other kinds of materials to the Department of Defense at this time. Is that correct?
Under terms of that department, that's true.
Well, why didn't the debarment extend to all materials that Morris would supply? Why did it extend only to the bolts?
At the time we considered that, which was last summer, we were right in the middle of the most controversial part of this whole activity. Our supplies had just been frozen. We were looking to salvage what we could in terms of readiness. Thought being on Morris, and this was discussed thoroughly within the legal circles. The thought on Morris was, can we get his attention, hurt him severely in these two stock classes, but still retain some deliveries in other stock classes? I guess you'd have to look at it as an innovative debarment technique that we tried.
Well,
very unusual. And looking back on it, I don't know that we'd make the same decision today.
Well, what decision might you make today?
We'd probably look harder at total debarment. It was an unusual circumstance. It was something we wanted to try.
What kinds of other materials is Morris supplying to the government today? Do you know?
A range of fasteners.
Other kinds of fasteners?
Hardware, fasteners.
Would you please supply to this subcommittee a list of all materials that Morris is in fact supplying under contract to the government today? A list of all materials that go beyond these two classes, 5305 and 5306. And Mr. Chairman, I would ask that the record remain open for that purpose.
Without objection, Thorne.
Thank you very much, General. That's all that I have.
Well, I'm going to move on, Mr. Pigotty, but I share my colleague from Virginia's concern. This may have sounded like an innovative debarment kind of procedure to you, but it sure looks to me like someone is not being dealt with as scrupulously as I'd like to see, and we will look forward to receiving those.
In retrospect, it would have been easier for us to debar them across the board. It would have been. This was an attempt to try to salvage something out of the situation, and something we really haven't done.
We hope that there is a lesson learned there. What would be the impact on a U.S. attorney of not going forward with debarment?
I can't answer. Okay.
Mr. Lorber and Mr. Barnett, some questions for you, because we discussed some issues last summer when you were here that I'd like to follow up on. Now, last summer you informed the committee of formal TACOM waivers to 6 defense contractors covering 9 weapons systems. And what we'd like to do is ask about some of the apparent informal waivers that weren't mentioned. I'd like the staff to show you a letter dated March 20, 1987. It's Exhibit 4 in the materials that you have. This is a letter, Mr. Lorber, from DCASR Atlanta to DLA headquarters, which Mr. Lesser of AMC disseminated to TACOM, among others, regarding five TACOM contractors in the region. Now, two of those contractors, Ingersoll Rand and Shoal American, conducted visual inspections of their fastener inventories and declared them okay. And Cadillac Gauge, upon determining that they had installed grade 8.2 fasteners in the V150 one-meter turret vehicle, merely changed the drawings to actually declare them okay. My question is, how did AMC and TACOM resolve these situations?
I'd like to ask Mr. Barnett, since it's a tech and automotive contractor.
I have to admit that I haven't seen this list before or quite understand what it all means. I'd be happy to respond in writing to the committee on it.
Well, why don't you do that? And we're particularly interested because the letter clearly states corrective action was to have been taken by May 30, 1987. We know of no such action up to this point and would be interested in a written response. Similar response was received from the Chicago region TACOM contractors, Mr. Lorber and Mr. Barnett. This is Exhibit 5 in your materials. Now, what this implies is that AM General had conducted visual sampling, physical test sampling, and chemical test sampling on the bolts to be installed on the M939 and HUM-5 vehicles, and that no waivers were granted. The subcommittee staff, however, as well as the DCIS, found suspect fasteners all over the HUM-5 examined at Fort Ord, and HUM-V, examined at Fort Ord, and also on the new Hummers delivered in April 1988 to Fort Ord and Fort Carson. It seems like there's a contradiction to us, and we would be interested in knowing how you all would explain such a contradiction.
Mr. Wyden, the letters that you're addressing were not sent to the Army. This is the first time we've seen them. The responsibility for the contract compliance in this case is with the Defense Contract Administration Services.
Now, Mr. Russo, do you know if AM General considers these bolts suspect, or whether the DCAS Pro at the AM General plant has ever been advised that these bolts don't conform to 8.0 standards?
Sir, I believe in April, rather... in the past, they have in fact, and at AM General, taken pretty strong action. First, in June of 1987, they had required all of their vendors to submit certifications on critical part numbers that the appropriate tests had been made on every item that came into their inventory. In November of 87. That was extended to all of the grade 8 bolts that they were taking on. They in turn began at the same time frame to do a chemical analysis on a 1 out of 10 lot of everything that came in from their vendors, sort of an independent test of what they were getting to assure that their inventory in fact was fairly pure.
Well, among the head markings that the subcommittee is concerned about is that of a Canadian producer, Infasco, whose mark consists of a hollow triangle. Now, Infasco's catalogs for bolts with this mark openly state that they don't meet the chemical specifications for a grade 8 bolt. These hollow triangle marked bolts were found again all over the Humvee vehicle. So I guess, again, my question would be, are you aware of whether AM General considers these bolts suspect, or whether the DCAS Pro at the AM General plant has ever been advised that these bolts don't conform to 8-point standards?
Are the bolts are talking about the 1541 fast alloy?
Yeah, thing? Those okay. are the Infascos.
Okay. Now those bolts are acceptable according to the SAE standard. That is an acceptable material in diameter 7/16 inch and below. So the specification allows substitution of grade 1541 bolt.
Can I ask you a question?
Let me yield to the staff for a question on this point.
The question is, do your contracts, did you pay for the grade for the 1541 or did you pay for the 8.0 alloy?
Okay, different question. But the answer there is the 1541 fast alloy thing has just recently come to our attention. There is a cost differential, certainly, and we should pursue consideration if he has in fact substituted that material. I'm not sure we've got that problem totally scoped in.
Well, the other thing concerns the validity of AM General's test, because the document that Mr. Wyden was quoting from and your testimony, General Russo, talk about an extensive chemical testing program as well as a physical testing program.
I don't want to beg on words. I did not use extensive. I said a chemical testing program. But okay. Having said that, keep going.
Well, the question is, are those tests of sufficient sensitivity to pick up the differential between grade 8 alloy bolts and those made with grade 1541 steel, which are non-alloy?
My understanding was that it did. I'll confirm that for the record.
Please.
Let me, if I might, just continue with these waiver questions. We moved from Atlanta to Chicago, and we also have questions with respect to the St. Louis regional DCA SR response as well, Mr. Lorber and Mr. Barnett. Here we've got a situation where Emerson Electric was granted a TACOM waiver to substitute 8.2 bolts for grade 8 bolts. However, Exhibit 6, which is in your materials, indicates that the determination of what was 8.2 was done by chemical analysis only, as we've been discussing. Given the evidence that hardness problems arise when 8.2s are plated, did you require Emerson to do any physical analysis?
The instructions that were put out with respect to waivers was that for a waiver be granted, and this is back in the interim period prior to 1 February 1987, that the contractors would in fact do tensile testing, whatever it takes to prove out their bolt, as well as an engineering analysis to indicate that it would, if it were an 8.2, it would work in that environment.
Now, the same exhibit indicates that while Southwest Mobile Systems had no TACOM contracts and thus were granted no TACOM waivers, they had grade 8.2s mixed in their inventories. They asked for a waiver on their TROSCOM, Troop Support Command contract, despite the fact that no product had been shipped at the time. Could you tell us what was the product and whether the waiver was granted?
Sir, I don't have the information available. I'll provide it for the record.
Okay. Southwest also had an additional contract. This one was with Armament Munitions and Chemical Command. In this case, they merely revised the drawing specifications from 8 to 5. Could you tell us what that product was and what kind of testing was performed and what you know about that product?
Sir, I will have to provide that for the record.
Well, please do, because you know it seems to me we have one of two unpleasant kind of results from this. If only a 5 was necessary, then either there was a screw-up in the original contract or the government obviously overpaid for the product. Doesn't it have to be one of the two, Mr. Lorber?
One of the two, but if it's a better bolt and we don't pay extra for it, that would be a suitable substitute.
And what evidence would we have that it's a better bolt?
Same, if it's a grade 8 from a recognizable supplier, that would be sufficient.
The other question on this, doesn't there have to be government approval to make changes in these specifications?
Yes, sir. The contractor has to identify it and ask for a waiver to use it.
Let me ask you a policy question, Mr. Lorber. Having sat through, I guess, four hearings now on bolts dating all the way back to when the late Secretary Baldrige came before our subcommittee to talk about bolts. Do you think, Mr. Lorber, that it would make sense as a policy, and we could see this done through legislation, for example, and there may be other ways to pursue this, that there be an original lab certification accompanying all transactions in these materials when they were going to be used for critical application?
Mr. Wyden, we would prefer having original lab certifications or the actual lab data furnished as a part of the certification.
Well, I think you're going to get what you want, and a lot of us are interested in pursuing that through legislation in particular, and it is good to hear of your support. Let me see if the minority or staff has any additional questions that they would like to ask. Mr. Nelson?
I'd just like, Mr. Chairman, to ask that the exhibits 1 through 14 be placed in the record at the appropriate places. Most of them correspond to questions that members have asked. And also that the record be left open for written questions to be provided to the witnesses.
Without objection, so ordered. And particularly since our witnesses have asked on a number of occasions to be able to supply additional information, we will leave the record open. Gentlemen, I would just say that this has not been a pretty picture, and I am particularly concerned that so many major questions are left outstanding. I mean, we have talked at some length about the problem with the grade eights, and to hear you say, Mr. Pigotty, that the problem with these grade threes is 100 times what it is with the grade eights indicates to me that we are going to have to move quickly and aggressively for quite some time to come. Chairman Dingell, as you know, has a great interest in this matter, and it seems to me that there is much to do, and this subcommittee wants to work with you to get it done just as fast as we possibly can. If you gentlemen don't wish to add anything, we will leave the record open, and our subcommittee is adjourned. Do you gentlemen care to add anything at this point?
I'd like to make a point on that class three.
Sure. On the class threes?
On the class three. Yeah. The attention and emphasis being given over the last, just since the last hearing, has caused an effect on the manufacturing community. And where we were finding 40% non-conforming threads when we last testified, in March, non-conformance rate was down to 20%, and last month we're getting 13%. So the manufacturers are starting to clean up their act just by virtue of the emphasis and attention that's being put on that class three problem.
Well, that is good to know, and there's no question that there seems to be a real flurry of activity around the time Chairman Dingell calls one of these hearings, but it seems to me that we have got to make a very aggressive effort to particularly deal with some of these things like the class threes, which by your own admission are much, much greater than anything that we've talked about. I mean, it seems to me that the picture that has been laid out today is serious in its own right, but to think that in your own words that the class threes are 100 times this indicates to me that we have much to do. And I know Chairman Dingell wants to pursue this with you and to work in cooperation with all of you. And I think a number of us on the committee are going to be very supportive of the legislation that I just discussed with Mr. Lorber. So with that, we appreciate your time, and the subcommittee is adjourned.
If you would like more information about this hearing, you can write to its sponsor, the House Energy and Commerce Subcommittee on Oversight and Investigations. The address is 2323 Rayburn Office Building, Washington, D.C. The zip code is 20515.
When we say that C-SPAN is a cooperative of the cable industry, we're acknowledging the fact that the cable industry created C-SPAN as a public service for the nation. Our board of directors is made up of 36 industry leaders from across the nation.